You are about to participate in the most ambitious culinary experiment ever imagined.
This competition is going to test everything.
Adapt quickly to anything. I mean anything. The wildest day of your life starts right now.
All new 24 and 24 Last Chef Standing. Sunday night at 8 on Food Network. Stream on Max.
About me.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
It's not college basketball. It's college
time. Let's get ready to rumble. Feel the fires into the rear. It's my son only know how.
Oh, okay, how about now? There we go. All right, I gave a whole spiel there, but I don't know if that helped. But I said, what is up, Friday Nighters? Welcome back to another edition, another episode of Just Another Friday Night. I'm one of your two hosts, CM Chuck. And that's...
Double A
Adamantium Adam for the second time around. Good to be back in the studio. Good to be back here with Double A in podcast land. Miss this guy. Miss being here talking with all of you guys. Greatly appreciate you guys holding out and hanging out while I underwent a little facial reconstruction. So previously a birthmark and a birthmark no more. So what do you think, Double A?
That looks great. Yeah, all right. At least you're not Jigsaw.
There you go. It could be worse.
Horse meat.
Or Willem Dafoe in Poor Things. Did you watch it?
No, but I saw what he looks like.
Yeah, it was pretty freaky. Pretty freaky. If you guys haven't watched Poor Things, go check it out. Double A, how the hell are you? How's your week been? How has the last 6 weeks been without this?
Busy. Just super busy. Just work. You know, that's it, really.
Cheers, Steve there, Double A. Not on the drinking.
I just got out of work not too long ago, so I'm just really tired.
Yeah, this guy's tired, so we're going to do our best here to make this one a quick one, but an informative and an interesting one for you because we have missed podcasting with you guys. Toy Mafia in the house says, yo, and our friend Lane Kramer says, hey, guys. Lane had some funny comments for us the other night on After Dark talking about, he goes, Magiomania running wild. I appreciate that. And Lane says, I'm looking forward to seeing how this new animated series goes, but don't have a ton of faith it will be great. I think it will be solid, but not fantastic. Definitely going to talk about that, Lane, for sure, because that is something that everyone's been talking about. I believe that Steve, cheers from both of us. Renard Stokes says, what's up, guys? What's up, Renard? Appreciate you being here.
No, that's just all the
Oh, yeah, that's all everyone telling us they couldn't hear us, but now we're back. Oh, Jerry, dang, no invite on X-Men episodes. He goes, have a great show, guys. Jerry, thanks, sorry, bud. Next time for sure, man. This one was we were off to the races, you know what I'm saying? Getting back into the groove of things. Yeah, there we go. Okay, now we're good that we can hear us. And that's it. Lane says, oh, the Enforcer is here with the man, the Nature Boy, holder of the Friday Night Stream World Championship. Okay, we'll take it, man. What's up, Chuck? Good week, Double A?
Yeah, solid. Yeah, very solid week.
Awesome, guys. Money-wise. Awesome. Yes, good. That's always good, too. Can't ever complain about that, guys. So, yeah. We appreciate you guys all being here, joining us tonight to join the conversation again. Don't forget, this is just another Friday night. San Antonio's premier pop culture podcast with Pee Breaks live on Fridays. Happy to be discussing things with you. Before we get started with our topic, though, guys, we want to bring in an opportunity to talk about a little bit of news. A lot of things have happened only in the last 6 weeks. Some of it's kind of old news now. So I only brought prevalent news, but I did want to pick your brain about a few things if I could. The Fantastic Four casting. How did you feel about it?
I like it.
You like it? Okay, great, yeah. great. I thought it was really good too. Love Pedro Pascal.
I'm kind of glad they picked someone that's older.
Yeah,
in Pedro.
Yeah, so, for Reed, and yeah. I think he's gonna come across as like the most intelligent man.
And Vanessa Kirby's great. I love her. I love her work.
Yes.
And Mission Impossible, and that's where I've seen her mostly.
Mm-hmm.
I forgot the dude's name that plays Eddie, but you know, obviously I'm sure he's gonna be really annoying. So
yeah,
just like Johnny. And I forget the other actor's name that's gonna play Ben, mm-hmm. but I have seen him in The Punisher. I have seen him in The Bear. And I like him. He's a wise ass. He's got a Brooklyn or New York accent. So I think he'll be perfect for the Thing.
So. Yeah. I think it's going to be really great, too. I think it's a great casting. I think Vanessa Kirby also comes out in the Napoleon movie.
Yeah, she does, but I haven't seen it yet either.
But yeah, but
I like her work in Mission Impossible. So
I definitely do want to check it out, mm-hmm. though. Yeah, for sure. And then, real quick, ladies, the Nurture Boy, because you helped build your pop culture. Thank you so much, Lane. I appreciate that, man. Without burying the lead, I popped up the picture already, how did you feel about the passing of this man?
That sucks. Another guy that you can say created a whole world, that mm-hmm. Worldwide, it's huge. Dragon Ball Z is very huge worldwide, and this was really unexpected, because I know he was still, like, I don't know, maybe 10, 12 years ago, like, he started doing Dragon Ball all over again. He got, like, the itch, and... Like, man, he just started making the movies. He started making a show. And
so he maintained involvement.
Except for GT. He had just came back. And this was, like, almost going to be the sequel to Dragon Ball Z.
Yeah.
And, man, just, like, out of the blue, 68. And I was like, oh, wow, okay.
Yeah.
Well, I wonder if they're going to keep going forward with it or not. But, I mean, if they don't, I'm sure people will be fine with it. You know?
Yeah.
It sucks. Another, you know, like you said, another creator, another world builder that we lost in the world, so that sucks.
You rank him up there, AA, with Stan and George Lucas?
Yeah, because, I say this because, obviously, the Z characters have bled over to pop mm-hmm. culture now. I mm-hmm. mean, when Goku hit the Macy's parade,
yeah.
you know, that was a big deal.
Yeah,
that's a cool. really big deal. So, I mean, yeah, I would say he's up there. He has to be up there.
You know, the fact that, like, my nephew, you know, and Jessica's nephew, AJ, is a huge fan, yeah. and he's 9. It's like, yeah. it's just been generational.
This,
you know?
This cartoon's been around since the 80s,
yeah.
and it's still going strong, you know,
yeah.
maybe even stronger. So, yeah, it's a huge loss. Huge loss.
Akira Toriyama, guys, age 68, creator of Dragon Ball Z. That's who we're talking about. I mentioned it at the top of last week's show because it was like breaking news. But obviously, I wanted to hear your thoughts
yeah,
as a
I
huge
mean,
fan.
Yeah, it just sucks. Yeah, just you like know. I said, it's like when you lose Stanley at Jack Kirby, you know, or someone
right.
like that, you know, it just sucks.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm going to read Lane's comments in reverse here because it made more sense. But he says, Toriyama, a true creative that is lost, like the creator Murata and Berserker.
And then he
yes.
also did, mm-hmm. I don't know if you know CM, but he did a game called Dragon Quest, but over here it's called Dragon Warrior.
Yes.
You remember the game
yes.
that my brother
loved? Yeah, your
Will,
brother loved that yeah. game. That was such a fun game.
Yeah,
I loved that game,
he had a
too.
Hand in that game.
Is that
yeah.
right? Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow. Toriyama. Toriyama or Murata? Toriyama?
No, Toriyama.
Toriyama. Yeah, yes, wow, yes. how cool is that? Dragon Warrior. Love that, man. That's mm-hmm. so cool. Then Lane says, it's kind of crazy because the VA of Dragon Ball, who is 86, outlived Toriyama. Oh, wow. Yeah, that's crazy. Yeah. The visual artist, I think, is that what that is? VA? I might be incorrect.
That's what I'm saying. It's just, it's weird. Like, all of a sudden, he just died at
yeah.
68. I mean, man, he had said he was going to do so much more, so.
Wow.
Yeah, so.
I mean, hopefully, maybe he had plans
because
that
he was
left
still
for
writing.
Someone.
He was still writing the anime, the, not the anime, the, what do you call him, the manga?
Manga. Yeah,
manga.
Yeah,
yeah.
Okay.
He was still doing that story. He already had written, like, about 3 or 4 storylines already ahead of where they ended.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I wonder where they're just going to go.
I hope that work is out there, because then
it'll
still get released.
It is.
Yeah,
it
okay,
is.
Cool.
They just need to animate it, and, yeah, but I don't know where they're going to go now. So.
And when the news broke, I actually heard it in the collecting group, and I recognized the name, but it didn't register right away with me that whose name, what he was tied to. So then once I, like, pulled it up, I was like, oh, wow, he created Dragon Ball. So rest in peace again, and huge,
yeah,
you know, passing of Toriyama. Yeah. Now I want to get to Lane's other comment here. He says, the one thing that hurt him this week, he says, was the Crow trailer, he says, or I mean Crow Wick 5 Goth Made in Rage.
You know what, Lane? I hate to disagree with you, but I actually saw it and I loved it, and I cannot wait for it.
Yeah.
I can't believe some of the shit they were actually showing in the trailer.
Yes.
He was blowing fucking people's heads off and, you know, taking the bullets, taking the sword wounds. I was like, damn, and he looks jacked.
Yeah.
You know, because people kind of forget, like, as great as the Brandon Lee one is, it doesn't follow the book either.
Okay. Really. Okay, you know? I didn't know that.
In the book, he's a mechanic.
Mm.
And they get killed on the side of the road, and Top Dollar is one of T-Bird's crews.
Oh, you know what I mean?
So, yeah, and then there's, like, a ghost that's following Eric. Okay. Around, you know, so, yeah, I mean.
Do
so.
You feel like this, from what you saw, maybe
no,
might
follow not this one either.
Okay, not
no,
either.
Not
okay.
this one either.
Real quick, we're trying something new this week, guys, so I do have a quick clip. I don't want to try to show the whole trailer because I don't want to get kicked off YouTube.
Yeah, okay.
But I'm going to show it to you guys real quick and see what we think about. If I can make this work, I don't know if I can make it work, but we'll try to show it real quick here. Because Zach had, you know, Zach from Collecting Weekly was just made the suggestion. He was like, hey, try some trailers if you can, or try some videos.
I didn't even know you could, yeah.
I don't, you know, I thought I could, but obviously I can't.
Okay.
This is what I'm seeing here. I thought I could do it. But
like I said, obviously
not.
It's missing we'll come back to obviously it. I wish it could have kept the crow paint.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But, you know, that's probably my only complaint about it. I'm up for it. I love revenge movies.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm really up for it. I mean, obviously they've made like what, six other Crow or four or five other Crow movies.
Right. Yeah.
So
and then
and I think they even had
really
a series.
Land. Yeah.
Stairway to Heaven, I think that's what it was.
Yeah, that's right. I totally
yeah,
forgot
so,
about
I mean,
that.
Yeah. This ain't like it's like a complete remake. It's like
right.
people kind of forget about 2, 3, and 4.
Yeah. The Edward Furlong was
yeah,
one.
Yeah,
because
like
then...
in part 2, the Sarah character gets killed.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
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 I thought there was even one where the Sarah character is the Crow. Is that?
Maybe it is.
I don't
is.
Know. Maybe.
I know Kirsten Dunst is in one of them, too,
oh, really?
Which is crazy. Yeah.
And the actress that played Trini in the Power Rangers.
That's
is
right.
One of
that's
them.
Right.
Is it she?
Yes.
Yeah, before
that's right.
she passed.
That's right.
Real quick, I think Lane, referring to Toriyama, says he also did the character design for Chrono Trigger.
Yeah,
whatever
man, man which is what a great
RPG
great
yeah.
fucking
creator. Man, seriously. Yeah. Oh, he says voice actress for Goku. Gohan and
oh, the family.
Goten. Oh, wow. Damn. Okay. She's the voice for all of them. Very cool. Jeremy in the house. Jeremy taking a break from spreading democracy and Helldivers is here to visit with us. Jeremy, appreciate you, brother. I know you're not probably really taking a break, but yeah. And Lane says, sorry, guys, but I do
well,
not I, like this trailer.
I don't even know. Did we get CM's comment? What did you think?
You know what? I think what I said was I was like, you know, is it going to be better than the original? No, because we're endeared to that movie.
Mm-hmm.
I love that, you know, Brandon Lee Crow. But I was intrigued enough by exactly what you said, Double A, the action, that I was like, oh, I'll watch it. I will definitely watch it because it looks... When I saw
I
that
mean,
shotgun to the face,
yeah,
I was like,
he's
that's
fucking
badass.
People up. I'm like, whoa.
Plus, I really liked Skarsgård at the beginning of Barbarian. You know, he has a,
oh,
he,
that's
he's
right,
in the
that's
beginning,
right, that's right.
And he's very, it was kind of cool to not see him, like, as Pennywise, and I was like, oh, he's very, you know, like, there's a certain edge to him, so I very much like that.
For a movie as beloved as Crow, it's always going to be hell. I think even if Jason Momoa was in this movie
mm-hmm.
and did exactly the same moves that Skarsgård was doing, mm-hmm. I think people would still be like, man,
yeah,
that
exactly.
movie kind of sucked, you know?
Exactly.
Or it looks bad, you know?
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
I
saw it. I liked it. I'm all for it. So
yeah. Lane says it doesn't have the look and feel of the original. The goth.
Yeah, I mean it helps. That one helps. You
is
know,
what helps
I
make
mean,
the movie. Yeah, no doubt.
But I don't
sure.
know how the city is gonna look though. You know,
yeah.
they really didn't show the city too much. They just show them kind of facing off like a big gang. It's not even
right.
like five guys. It looks like
yeah.
it's a whole group of people. So.
And in the book, Double A, does it have? Well, is it supposed to be Detroit, right? It's supposed to be Detroit.
I believe
Burton.
So.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
what you know. Well, at least in the Brandon Lee version, it was Detroit because
yeah.
it's Devil's Night and all that. So, Arellis in the house says, "Hey everyone, Arellis, we appreciate you being here. Thanks, it's been a while since we've seen you." Lane also says, "The City of Angels plot and such, they cut a lot." He says, "One thing I am." Glad they did was originally the Yellow
okay,
Ranger.
So she was in part two.
Yeah,
okay.
right. she falls. In, oh, wow. She broke her back in the movie.
Because I do remember
Damn.
She was a villain. I was like, huh, I wonder if she did that originally.
Yeah, it says she originally she is still alive, and well, I will leave it as she got a geez, yikes.
Oh, wow.
I don't think I knew all that. Yeah,
yeah
I look up her past, but yeah. But yeah, I was trying to pop up the trailer for you guys, but I guess I don't have the ability to.
But guys, it's out there. It just
yeah, it's
premiered
out there. Yeah.
yesterday,
Oops.
So
yeah. we'll get to that in a minute.
It just premiered yesterday. I was blown away by it. I'm gonna see it when
yeah.
it comes out.
You know, I will say this. I thought it looked. It looked better than I thought it was going to look. And I was like, okay, cool. Because when I first saw the images of him, I was like, what's with the look? Whatever. They're kind of giving him this, you know.
I mean, look, if he did Brandon Lee. People are going to right away just say he's it's Brandon Lee.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? And that's not fair to him. I mean, that movie is just really is going to overshadow this movie real bad.
Yeah.
I mean, it's gotten stronger and stronger as the decades have gone on.
Absolutely.
The Crow's in its 30th year. It's kind of fitting that they're kind of releasing your Crow on the 30th anniversary of the Brandon Lee one, so that's pretty cool.
Yeah, I think our friend Foxy Roxy said, she goes, I don't mind that it's the Crow, she's like, but I do mind that it's like Eric Draven and Shelley Webster. I think she wishes it would have been like maybe other characters, but then again, I feel like Eric Draven is who's tied to the Crow, kind of hard to do it without or whatever, but, and then anything that you do, you
how crazy is it, though, right? Like, James O'Barr, this guy's really only known for the Crow, and I think that's all he's ever done. And he's had such a big franchise with the movies.
Yeah.
Love him or hate him. I mean, there's been so many fucking movies made on this one story and a show. I mean, it's just, it's crazy.
And again, testament to the popularity and the love for the character.
That it's people an just enduring want. Story. Yeah. On, you know, I mean.
But they just want some Crow. Yeah. So you gotta, you know, bring it out.
Yeah.
Real quick here.
It's that third, this, last, this that one, yeah.
Lane says, I think the movie just feels like John Wick to me.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be there, Lane. I mean, obviously, that shit's just in right now.
Yeah.
The, I just saw, kind of action.
Did you see the trailer for that Monkey Man with Dev Patel? Mm-hmm. I got that same vibe. I was like, oh, they're going with a kind of
It's kind of like when the Bourne movies came out, everyone started doing that kind of fighting style. You know what I mean? Even they updated Bond for that kind of style with Casino Royale and everything. So, I mean.
When Under Siege came out, it was supposed to be speed on a boat. You know,
Die Hard. Die Hard on a bus.
Die Hard on a bus. Right. You Die know? Hard on a bus. Yeah. So that's just, you know, what was the other one? That Taken. Everyone was saying, oh, Liam Neeson, this is like the new Taken. This is like a Taken.
Yeah. But
they were already kind of doing the Bourne movies and all that stuff. You know, I think some of that stuff will always kind of be there overlapping. Quick question here from Lane. Did you guys see Dune Part 2?
I'm still kind of waiting.
Nor have I.
I'm waiting for my cousin, Amy, who you saw last week. She said she wanted to go see it too. She's the only one I know that actually likes the movie, so that's why I wanted to go see it with her.
You but know? You just really want to see Part 2, though, because everyone keeps telling us that this is the one, like, you want to see. That one was kind of like the lead-in, and then this one was like,
man, everyone keeps kind of saying that it was slow. I didn't think it was slow at all, man. I think it was just a really great setup. I mean, the family gets betrayed.
Right,
the Emperor, you know?
Well, I think what I felt
terrible. Like... it's terrible. What happens, spoilers, if you haven't seen it, first of all, what happens to the dad, you know, Oscar Isaac, you know, it's like, damn,
Well, and I think I felt too, like, right when it was about to get good, you know, that's when it ended. Yeah. And I was like, oh, well, fuck. You know, like, it was a good little cliffhanger. And I was like, it's finally picking up, but we're not, you know, I got to wait. And now all this
time has passed. Yeah, so, man.
I definitely want to get out to see it, too. Maybe we can all do that together. Okay. That'd be great. Real quick, Lane says, I know you're focused on X-Men 90s. I watched every episode, I remember it. I still love Dark Phoenix, Beyond Good and Evil, Final Showdown with Apocalypse story. Mm-hmm. Excellent stuff. I'm definitely going to talk about some of those. He says, I know I am smashing my old man.
No,
button.
I mean, you have every right, Lane. I mean, if you didn't like it, you didn't like it. It's not for you.
I would say this, though. Like, Lane, would you watch it free on streaming? Like, I mean, I get it. You might not go to theater for it, but would you
I mean, it sounds like you saw the other ones.
Yeah. So, for sure.
But no, I mean, I'm not bashing you. If you say it sucks, hey, you know, it sucks for you. I mean, that sucks. I mean, a lot of people were like that. A lot of people felt like, man, he looks like shit. He looks stupid.
Yeah.
I think, you know, it's cool. You know, it looks cool. It looks action-packed. And hopefully it's just not 3 hours. Hopefully it's like
That would be one thing. You know, I think Jimmy Kimmel made a comment about that during last week's Sunday's Oscars about just like how every freaking movie was like three and a half hours.
I'm like, damn.
I know. It's like, geez, like between, you know, Killers of the Flower Moon and then what was the other long one?
It's like Indiana Jones, Mission Impossible was 3 hours.
Right.
Like 3 hours. Napoleon was like 3 hours. Man, it was like the summer, like 3 hour movies. I was like,
yeah, that's intense.
Me.
You know, and I think it's asking a lot of an audience.
Guardians was almost 3 hours.
It's asking a lot of an audience of the TikTok generation that's less inclined to spend so much time on something.
There's certain movies that deserve the 3 hours, and then there's certain movies that, man, you really didn't need that 3 hour
right.
movie. Like we've said it before, there could have been so much more editing in a lot of that shit where you could have got rid of this, you could have got rid of that. You know, it's like, but everyone feels like they have to put every fucking thing in there now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, no, it didn't have to be.
You know, the gal that won for editing, I think was, the other long movie was Oppenheimer. I think she won, and I was kind of like, what was left? Like, how long was the fucking movie? Like, she left a lot in, you know?
That was a long movie. It was interesting, but it was long.
Yes, it was very long. And I got to say, of the Oscar nominees that I did watch, which, you know, I think I liked them. I liked Poor Things probably the best, then The Holdovers, then Oppenheimer, and Killers of the Flower Moon last.
It's just one of those years, CM, where it was like Robert Downey was finally due. He had his Leo moment, Al Pacino moment. Christopher Nolan finally got his Oscar.
Deserved.
It was one of those deals. Sure. Like Scorsese when he finally won for Departed.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean.
No, absolutely.
I think that's really what it was.
And that movie looked like it got snubbed all the way around.
What's that?
Of Colors of the Flower Moon. I don't think it got anything. Yeah. So it just
Scorsese just always gets it. Right. Like Tarantino has produced so many like Oscar winners in his movies. And I think Scorsese, I think it's only been like De Niro.
Yeah.
I think that's the only one that won from his movies, I think.
That's crazy, right? Yeah, because Leo won for...
From The Revenant, and that's not even Scorsese. Oh, that's right.
Different one. So.
Yeah.
That's interesting, too, when you think about
it. Like, I really thought of any movie he should have won, I thought maybe Wolf of Wall Street, you know, because he's so different in that movie.
Yeah,
you know,
and he's really great, too, for sure. And Lane did confirm he would watch it on streaming, so there's still a desire to check it out. Cool. No, it's good. Good stuff.
Well, it's a Crow. It's a Crow property. Like I said, it's just an enduring story.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So...
Absolutely. Well, without further ado, we want to get into the topic tonight, guys.
And don't feel like, you know, state your opinion. That's what you're here for.
Yeah, totally, man.
State your opinion.
Again.
We're not right, you know?
Yeah, for me, hey, I'd watch
it. I'm going to watch it and be like, man, that movie was the shit.
Yeah, that happens, right? How many times have we seen a great trailer that I'm like, whew, boy,
that was... Yeah, that trailer was the only thing that was great about it.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I don't think I hated Madam Web as much as other people did, because I saw some movies and I was like, I better watch Madam Web. Yeah, I can't
imagine how much hate that one. Yeah. Wow. Even Sydney Sweeney came out like on SNL.
Making fun of it.
Yeah, I was like, damn.
Yeah, I mean, even that. The movie's kind of worth watching for the babe factor. There's plenty of babes in there.
She is.
Yeah.
She is
a good babe. But without further ado, guys, as Lane mentioned earlier, and as you guys know, we're going to talk about tonight, in a couple of days, next Wednesday.
Yeah, next Wednesday. And I think it's going to be one at a time?
I think one at a time.
Oh, and real quick, Invincible. See, the part two. Started already.
Yeah, and that one's going to be one per week. Invincible Thursday is what they're calling it. Hashtag Invincible Thursday. Me and my nephew watched it already. Boy, you got to catch up.
You got to catch up.
Because I know he's going to want to come on and cover that with us. Cool. So, and I'd love that too. Next Wednesday, X-Men 97. So this is the continuation from the classic 90s animated series that I grew up with, that AA grew up with, and I think, you know, what I keep hearing everyone say, that a whole generation grew up with, that maybe didn't read the comics, but they were able to get more than their foot in the door with this, you know, animated series that was on Fox Kids, because it
great Saturday morning lineup, man, what a great lineup that was.
And AA, it leaned heavily on the source material, yes, right?
It so, really did.
You know, I learned a lot from that cartoon that I didn't know.
But about, I did learn some things that was kind of interesting when I was going back and reading about it. So, like, One Man's Work, do you remember that one where they kill Xavier?
Vaguely.
Okay, so it's like the one where Wolverine and Storm are lovers in the future.
Yes, I do remember that one now.
That one inspired the Age of Apocalypse storyline. I did not know that.
Wow.
They were like, the writers were like, man, that's kind of cool, but what if instead of like this happening, what if we kill Xavier and it's the Age of Apocalypse? And I was like, wow.
Okay.
You know, so that was pretty cool. I really did enjoy that.
Yeah, that's awesome. I'm going to go back and watch that. Yeah.
And it was. That was a really good, that's a really good two-parter.
Hey, it's Kaylee Cuoco for Priceline. Ready to go to your happy place for a happy price? Well, why didn't you say so? Just download the Priceline app right now and save up to 60% on hotels. So whether it's Cousin Kevin's Kazoo Concert in Kansas City, go Kevin! Or Becky's Bachelorette Bash in Bermuda, you never have to miss a trip ever again. So download the Priceline app today. Your savings are waiting.
Go to your happy place for a happy price. Go to your happy price, Priceline.
I don't know where this image is I grabbed from, but it has the Ultra HD 8K in there. But we are talking about X-Men 92 through 96. And the reason why they're calling this new one 97, right, AA, because it's supposed to pick up right from where the other one left off.
Yeah, supposed to be, yeah.
Yeah. And I was curious, too. I was like, why is it calling it 97? But I was like, I guess that would have been the next year.
And, man, that was that last season was really kind of hard to watch the second half. Mm-hmm. The art got really bad. The animation got really bad. It went from, like, that really cool, crisp look to, like, chunky.
Oh, wow.
I got like a really chunky look, but there were some cool stories. They did the Cap and Wolverine story.
Yes.
They did that. They did an origin story of Mr. Sinister. That was pretty cool.
Okay.
Yeah. So, I mean, there was some cool stories. And then at the end, like, Xavier kind of goes off with the Shi'ar because he's dying.
Interesting.
Or you know, he does die.
I remember that last season.
And so Magneto actually takes over the X-Men.
Okay.
As his wish, as his last wish. So I was like, huh.
Okay. Oh, so I definitely want to watch that before
yeah,
I
get into you this need new to. One. Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, cool. Because it was like, as I was rewatching some of the earlier seasons and some of my favorite episodes, I was like, I remember those like thoroughly. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So I was like,
no, but it's like a lot I of aged time, up like, season, over the five. Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Season five, it aged. You know, for yeah. a lot of people left.
Left
by that point
because it aged. Yeah.
Yes, or just you know they weren't into it anymore. You know what I mean?
Yeah, because as you guys know, Double A is a little bit younger than me, and so in '92 I must have been like 12, maybe.
No.
13.
6 years older.
In 91, I would have been 10, so in 92, I would have been 11.
Okay, sense, right? Okay, yeah, 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 yeah.
So 11, so, you know, and it was five seasons, right? So 11, 12, yes. 13, 14, 15. Yes, which, yeah, that's about the
yeah,
time.
You would have been like, I'm not going right. to wake up for this shit anymore.
Yeah, and I don't think I even knew that it was maybe, like, still going or something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, but man, by that point, it already kind of had lost its people, so.
Yeah, yeah. I want to get some quick comments from Lane here that says, he goes, I really just hoping they really do not. Oh, he goes. Oh, sorry, I missed one here. He goes. Oh wait. He goes. No, but I mean, let's talk about some X-Men. And he says, I don't think X-Men is going to remind us of Invincible in content. No, definitely not. No. He goes. I'm just hoping they really do adapt X-Men Blue storyline. Oh, do not. With this X-Men Blue storyline with the new Nightcrawler was procreated.
Remember I told you.
Right. Yes.
Like
that
now,
story.
Mystique can turn into her whole DNA.
No, definitely. I'm not for that either. He says, yeah, the very end was not good. It had a decent ending episode with Professor X having to go live in space. And he says, no, Xavier did not die in the final episode. He could be
just had to go
by the Shi'ar technology. He just could not return to Earth. I feel like some of that's kind of familiar, but I don't really remember.
You're not really going to remember because I remember when I finally went back to see those, not this year, but many years ago, I was like, wow, I completely missed this.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then real quick, just I want to show you guys what we're talking about here. Obviously, the X-Men 97, which is coming again next week. And we're not talking about that. We'll talk about that when it's done. But we're just talking about right now the original from the 90s, 92 through 96, the five seasons. You know, what do you really remember, Double A? Like, what are your, you know, the fond memories of that?
So after I was, like, kind of going back, I really didn't even realize kind of, like, the storylines kind of, like, in the... It seemed like the first season was kind of, like, very heavy solo episodes, I guess, maybe. I'm kind of, like, going looking those. But I know season two was very Mr. Sinister heavy.
Okay.
Very Mr. Sinister. Then season three was, like, the first season was, like, yeah, Code Vengeance, that's Wolverine's story.
Classic.
Captive Hearts, that's Cyclops and Jean with the Morlocks.
Yes, great story.
You know, the Night of the Sentinels, the first episode, Magneto's mm-hmm. story,
yeah.
Juggernaut's story, you know, Archangel, Apocalypse kind of gets in. But then, yeah, like, season two is like Mr. Sinister heavy.
Mm-hmm.
There's some other episodes, but it's like where Magneto and Xavier are like in the Savage Land. Remember?
Yes, working? I do remember some of those. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Season three had like the Phoenix. That was big
that
for
was, I remember
season
that being
three.
Huge, yeah.
The first part of when she becomes Phoenix and then the second part when she becomes Dark Phoenix.
Yes.
That took up a lot of Saturdays. I remember I was kind of pissed off.
And it was like you didn't want to miss any of them. You were like, damn, because, you know, back then if you weren't like recording on a VCR, it was like, man, if I miss it, when the hell am I going to catch it again? You know what
and
I
like
mean?
Throughout all these too, they do like a lot of time story travels, which were really, really cool.
Mm-hmm.
The fourth season was the Apocalypse one. That's like the big one for that fourth season was the Beyond Good and Evil.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
And then like season five starts off really good with the Phalanx episode. I don't know if you remember that
one. You know,
one.
And that one I don't remember. I think I actually read some of those comics, but I don't think I watched that.
Yeah,
those
but then it's kind of like it starts with episode five, the weird kind of animation where it's like, it's the Fifth Horseman. It says that one's where Cortez comes back.
And
he's trying to bring Apocalypse back. And then one of them's like Jubilee's Fairy Tale. That was kind of funny.
Okay.
Old Soldiers is a camp. Captain
yeah, that's
Wolverine.
The one. I remember that one.
Yeah. Cannonball, I have forgot he had came out in
oh, wow.
the end.
I definitely don't remember that.
Sinister's origin and then the very last episode. So
okay. Yeah. Okay. How long were they each? Double A?
Just
there?
Like 22
minutes.
Episodes? Yeah.
But in, and
super
the season
fast.
Were only like, what, 20 episodes?
Let me see. Because they upped the order for it.
Mm-hmm.
I think the first one only has like 10.
Okay.
Let me see.
And real quick, well, I'm going to read Lane's
comment. Okay, real quick. Season 1 had 13.
Okay.
Season 2 had 13, but then they upped it for season 3. It had 19. Man. Season 4 was at its peak, 21 episodes. And then season 5 had 10 episodes.
Okay, wow. It's still kind of like light for, you know, a kid's show. You would think there'd be like, you know, some of the other ones we've seen, they've got like, you know, like freaking Batman the Animated Series, yeah. Right? It's like tons of episodes.
And then they're saying here, too, that the viewership for like Saturday at its peak, they were getting like around 23 million households that were watching the X-Men. Wow. I mean, you got to imagine it's kids from like the 70s and 80s that were probably into, like, maybe someone like Phil was probably watching it. You can still imagine him seeing probably all this shit, you know, like, whoa, they're actually adapting the comic books.
Totally. You know, just watching the episode where, you know, Enter Magneto, you know, I think episode 3.
That was brutal.
You know, but, like, I didn't realize how they don't say, you know, like, he's from Germany, that it was the Nazis. They just say, you know, like, he's from a war-torn country, you know. So they leave a lot of little things but it still played very well. You know, like, I was like, oh, man, like, like, that's how I knew who these people were. You know what I mean? Like, that things I didn't know until, you know, hadn't read the comic books yet. You know, some of the comic books yet. So then you just learned as you were watching the X-Men, you know? Real quick, just to get to some of Lane's comments, he said here, I think my favorite design from the show is Mr. Sinister, and his design translated so well
into the
animation.
Really,
absolutely, yeah. I just remember him looking scared with the black lips and the sharp teeth. I was like, what the hell, you know what I mean? He says, yeah, they made Sauron a big threat. It was that series I got first introduced to Shauna the She-Devil. Yes, very nice.
Shauna. Kazar.
Yeah, Kazar. Good old Kazar, man. Yeah, and his saber-toothed cat. Uh-huh. Yeah, the whole Savage Land, you know what I mean? Just, I mean, I think I can remember one. Like all those figures, man, that had come out, and
those figures were really cool. And what was cool about that time, it was like they were like every toy store, and they're only for like six, seven bucks. So, I mean, man, you can buy at least two figures a week,
absolutely,
maybe, if you wanted to, and just keep building. I mean, that's how cheap these toys were,
And it's funny because Soren was one of the ones I had. I was like, and he came with like in his loincloth, and he had like a club, you know what I mean? So, and I think they were even putting out characters that weren't even in the cartoons.
Yeah, they had an X-Force line.
Yeah,
they had Strife, they had Cable, Deadpool, Domino, Shatterstar. They had those figures too. So,
and you know what's interesting too for me, AA, is at this time for me, I think like my comic reading and my watching were blending a little bit. So I was seeing some things. You know, and Lane, you know, you mentioned what you didn't want to see. And I've told AA this before, and I think I've mentioned it on the show, but one thing I did hope to see, and I think the episodes are out already, like what they're going to be called. So I didn't see it in maybe this run of X-Men 97, but I really was hoping they would do a couple of, Age of Apocalypse episodes and some Onslaught episodes and kind of really lean into some of those things that happened in the comics that they didn't put into the cartoon. Those are some of the
things. Well, this one sounds interesting. So, like, episode 2 is called Mutant Liberation Begins.
Mm.
The Mutant Liberation Front was Strife's group, so that'd be kind of cool.
Yeah.
They have Fire Made Flesh, Motendo / Life Death. Ooh, Life Death. That's like the Barry Windsor, Chris Claremont.
Oh, okay.
Shit. Remember It, Life Death Part 2, Bright Eyes, Tolerance is Extinction.
Mm.
And that's a three-parter one, that one.
Okay. So that's going to be, this new season is going to be 9? Or did I count wrong?
10.
10, okay.
Yeah, and so it's March 20th. Two are going to be premiering next Wednesday, and it's going to be like the 27th, the 3rd. 10, 17, 24, May 1st, 8th, and the 15th. So,
and I can guarantee you guys, we'll be watching, but we won't talk about it until it's done. So once it's done, I can definitely guarantee we're going to do an episode on that, because I don't really see there's a way we could like totally hate it unless it's just like really weird or something like that. You know what I mean? Like, so that would be, you know, again, we'll wait and see. You know, obviously the big news too, AA, was that the showrunner got fired, right? Like this
week.
Yeah,
like right away.
Suddenly.
Yeah.
Apparently he'd worked on like, he has worked on The Witcher. He has worked on he was working on some of the new Blade movie, and you know, apparently he's African American and homosexual. Not that those have anything to do with it, but apparently it was like an interesting firing for, you know, like,
I don't know, maybe he just ruffled some feathers,
right? Or
who knows?
Could have been an old tweet. I heard he had an OnlyFans again. The stuff's confirmed or whatever. Yeah. But well,
I mean,
they said it was
at Disney.
They said it was an OnlyFans, but not a racy one.
Yeah, but still, I mean, OnlyFans. You can only think of
it has a negative association, right? Yeah.
Yes.
So I was, you know, that's interesting.
I mean, it's Disney. Come on, people.
Right. So there's that. It's like, you know, and of course people are like claiming wokeness and all that or whatever. But I'm like, I don't know if that has anything to do with it. If anything, we see how quickly they separated from Jonathan Majors, it could be that maybe he just had an old tweet or some shit that he said something, or maybe he got over. I just heard Aaron Rodgers had some crazy comments about Sandy Hook. Oh, yeah. And I'm like,
no, that's always been his MO.
This fucking guy.
I mean, that's,
man,
why Adam even wanted him off.
Well, I know. I'm just like, man, this guy's trying to get canceled, I guess. And I'm like, bro, it's not the culture to be saying shit like that. And I know you want to, like, say whatever you want, but I mean, it's like, it depends on what you're doing. Some people can say whatever they want, some people can't because you're Aaron fucking Rodgers.
Comes out stupid, that's why.
Exactly, right. Yeah, and I'm like, don't you have
come down here and tell the parents that it wasn't real.
Right. Don't you have national sponsors, buddy? Aren't you trying to protect your pocketbook? Yeah. Like, I just feel like sometimes these people are doing shit that I'm like, we wouldn't do if we had everything going for us.
No, this is the era of just anybody saying shit.
Right.
And people believe it or not. You know what I mean? Even though the facts are out there.
Yeah, these are the people that would be hating on the mutants. Yeah. Right? Yeah. That's my segue back in right there.
Yeah,
see?
There you go.
Real quick, I want to read Lane's comments here. He says, they also had season 3 series with Garrock in this episode. I do remember Garrock, the fucking statue, whatever. He goes, in the first season, I remember a character that caused me the most fascination was Cable. Absolutely. I loved it. I will always remember, you know, they're like, who are you? You know, I'm the wild man of Borneo.
And you know what? It's funny because, like, Rob Liefeld on his podcast was, like, blown away, and he always repeated that line. He was like, the wild man of Borneo. Like, you don't know, he goes, you know how fucking, you know how pumped up I was to see my character. I was already at Image Characters, and Cable is there, and he's not just there for one episode. He's there for, like, multiple episodes. He was like, I was blown away. I was like, wow.
And let me tell you, Double A, and I don't know if you know the name of those episodes, but I can almost vividly remember in my mind when my watching kind of ended, because I was watching those Cable episodes, and I might have caught a couple afterwards. But I was always waiting for that one where, like, he's going back in the past, and then he sees something that, like, who he's supposed to protect or some shit, and he's like, no, not Apocalypse. Yes,
that's Time Fugitives, I believe.
Yes.
It's the one where Bishop saves his future, but it causes Cables to fucking die out.
Right.
And, yeah, he does that line, no.
Yeah, and then he says, to save my future, I must help Apocalypse destroy it. And I remember being like, I got to see this. And I never saw it. I never saw it for fucking years.
Oh, wow, really?
And so I was like, and I don't think I've still seen it on Disney yet, but I was like, so I kind of remember,
you need to see part 2. It's great. It has a great ending.
I remember being so freaking bummed that I didn't catch it. And I was like, what happened in that?
You'll like it a lot.
Well, at least if I did see it, I can't remember it right now off the top of my head. But I mean, like, there's so many episodes I do remember that just freaking stuck in my head, you know? In fact, Double A, I was looking for the clip because I really wanted to re-see it. But I always thought one of the most, like, touching, like, well-written spots was when Cyclops is captive, right?
Uh-huh.
I think he's captive with the Starjammers. And Corsair tells him, he goes, and I remember my son, he had his mother's eyes. You know, and you're like, you know that it's Cyclops, but you can't see his eyes.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my gosh, how freaking gut-wrenching is that? Like, that's so clever, it's so good.
The episode you need to see, it's Time Fugitives Part 2.
Time Fugitives Part 2. Okay, I'm definitely going to put that on the boxes tonight. Yeah. Tonight. Real quick. Right here?
Up there.
Up one?
Right there.
This one?
No, yeah, right there.
No, I think we read this one.
No. He's talking about Cable. Okay, and then he goes,
he's such a badass to me. Yeah. Absolutely. He says, I wonder if they will bring back Friends of Humanity and Great
you know,
Creed.
I told my wife, because she came in when I was watching, like, some of those episodes, because I think it's an Apocalypse episode.
Mm-hmm.
And, well, it's actually, I think, that same one, at Time Fugitives. And I go, man, what a great name they came up with for, like, a white supremacist group. Like, yeah. Friends of Humanity. I was like, you know, I was like, that's a great name that the comic book guys put, you know, instead of, like, putting, like, Ku Klux Klan or some shit like that.
Damn, Double A, doesn't it almost feel like it could be something, you know, like, make America great again, you know what I mean? Like, fuck, the connotations, right? And I always remember that episode because I bought the fucking Sabretooth figure that they made that was based, I think, solely on that episode where he's in the black teeth when they throw him off.
Yes.
And he's like, no,
we have that toy.
Not him.
Yeah.
Like, and I was like, dude, that guy's fear
he
was
fucking
real.
Scary. Well, he looks scary.
Oh, dude, fucking Sabretooth was
Sabretooth's like living like in this little fucking house in the middle of nowhere, and he just comes out. He's not wearing a costume. He has his hair out. But his
claws, fucking white eyes.
Yeah,
which
his
I'm like,
claws are all out. He's not wearing fucking shoes or socks or anything. He just looks like a hillbilly. And then he just picks up Graydon just like nothing.
Yeah.
Like from the ground.
And he gives him a line,
he's like,
too.
Come here, boy.
Yeah. Yeah. I was like, oh, shit. And, dude, just the other day, I'm watching, right? Like, to get ready for this episode. And it's the one where Sabretooth is there already in the X Mansion, like, but strapped him. And they don't know he's a bad guy yet. You know, Wolverine's trying to get him out. You know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So then, fucking, he's like, Jubilee's like, oh, your wrists are all hurt or whatever. And my dad's sitting, he's looking at it, and then he sits down. He starts watching it. And I go, Dad, would you undo it? He's like, nah, she's going to get it right now.
Look at that
she's
monster.
Gonna get it. Dude, he looked like a fucking monster. That's why when those native, the Antarctic people are like, they're like, man, a snow demon.
Yeah, snow demon. I was like, man, they recognized it. Yeah, they recognized it.
I always remember, too, you and your brother, you know, Will, talking about how Sabretooth had a fucking, like, a 12-pack.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, 12-pack.
I was like, God, that guy had abs for days.
Jubilee, like, really went fucking crazy on his design. I was like, damn.
And that episode, Cold Vengeance, is so filled with lines. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, you have a coward's love. Like, man, he just couldn't stand it that Wolverine was alive.
Yeah, or Wolverine, there's no peace for me.
I was like,
not even here.
I was like, man, this shit is fucking too heavy, man. I'll get
that's
emotional.
That's what's great about it,
I know,
right?
Yes.
Like, it holds up because of that kind of emotion. Just like the Batman animated series.
Yeah.
It holds up because of that.
That episode, those episodes are like still perfect today. Like, I could show this to my nephew and I know he'd be like enthralled by them.
Yeah, and then I forgot what episode it is too, but I remember like you saying it like a lot of times during this part where, you know, Wolverine's like, you like picking
on
people
yeah.
bigger than me. While I'm smaller,
yeah.
try picking on me.
Yeah, absolutely, man.
And that's
yeah.
what I always loved about Wolverine, man. He didn't give a shit.
And they made him,
come on,
dude,
fight.
Such a badass. And then, like, too, of course, obviously, they can't cuss on, like, a cartoon. But, like, all the stuff that
it
he would say
worked,
was great.
Right?
Man, you're slime. Yeah. Man, come. I can always deal with punks like you.
Yeah.
I was like, damn, he's really, like, spitting it out.
Or
you know?
Even, like, even just that punch he gives Cyclops in the stomach. Like, when Cyclops leaves Morphion, you just see him where he's not saying anything. Like, they just draw Wolverine just walk right up to Cyclops and just fucking punch him in the stomach. I was like, whoa. Like, holy shit.
Which, you know, they're kind of building Cyclops as a dick in that, you know, series as well. So you're kind of like, well, is he, you know? Of course, this is a classic from, like, I think episode two or three when they're going after Magneto.
Oh, that's right.
He gives him that classic.
That's
line.
Right.
I had it here, but I guess I can't play it. But, you know, where he tells Xavier off, you know, oh, we get to go after your old enemy, but we got to go easy on mine.
Yeah.
And it just cuts to Xavier, like, with his face, like, you bitch.
Yeah.
Like, you raggedy bitch. I can't believe you said that to me. But it's just, like, you know, there's so many moments like that, you know. Let me get a couple more of Lane's contract. Did you guys ever see the anime's intro for the... Yes.
No,
Roxanne posted this recently. I think Jerry D posted it. And... That animation from that anime looks so cool, but it has its own theme music, right? You know, the classic anime.
Yeah.
And somebody goes, man, somebody should cut it with the X-Men
music.
Cartoon. So Roxanne did it. She was able to do it. And boy, did it go hard, though. Like, I'll find it and show it to you. It's very cool. But Lane says, when they aired it in Japan, I mean, it's got Reavers, Magneto, and Brood attacking Wolverine and Omega Red and Cable shooting. Yes, that's an excellent opening. I'll definitely show that to AA Lane. And he says, LOL, I was literally just typing, calling himself the Wild Man of Borneo. he says, oh, yeah, come give Papa a kiss, which is so menacing.
Yeah, come to Papa.
Yeah, I'm like, fucking, fucking Sabretooth, man. I'm like, dude, he's fucking, it was terrifying.
Yes,
it's terrifying.
That is the last one. That's the episode where he gets Mystique, Rain and Creed. He gets Mystique, Rogue, and Nightcrawler all together.
Yes.
Because he's going to try and kill them all to make sure there's nothing that links him to his family.
Oh.
Because Mystique's his mom.
Right.
Nightcrawler is his half-brother.
Yes.
And then Rogue is obviously the adopted daughter of Mystique. So.
Yeah. But damn, he wasn't trying to go after his dad, huh?
We need a whole army for that one.
I was like, you know, as terrifying as Sabretooth was in this cartoon, like, that version of him, like you said, AA, the barefoot hillbilly Sabretooth was even more terrifying.
And not just that, but if he knows anything about Sabretooth, right, if he has all the files, he knows Sabretooth is also not just an animal, but he's also a fucking guy that has a lot of skills.
Oh, yeah.
You know, he was part of the Weapon X program, you know, he has that pass as a fucking agent, you know?
Absolutely.
So he's not someone to be fucked with either, you know?
And he seemed to genuinely hate people that hated mutants. Like, he was like, oh, he was quick to kill. Like, oh, you don't like us? Well, I don't like you either. Like, I have no problem taking you down, you know? Just some more imagery here, guys. Of course, the classic looks. these costumes, like you said, double A, based on the Jim Lee design, right?
Well, like the Cyclops, Jean, Jubilee, somewhat Storm, right? Rogue. But Wolverine, obviously, that's a classic. Beast, obviously, that's what he looked.
Right, right. Yeah.
But yeah, mostly the Jim Lee.
Classic blue Beast there. I see. I think this was the clip I have. But I thought when I set this up, there was a button to hit play. But
so pretty much on that part, like, it's great. There's no talking, nothing. Wolverine just walks right up to Cyclops and punches him in the stomach. He's like, fuck you.
I just hear that kind of classic weird 3D ending that they had there. You remember that?
I liked it. Yeah, because I always tried reading it, but it always went too fast,
right? But it was something very, very cool from that time. But what else, Double A? What else are some of your memories? What was
kind of cool, too, is kind of like, you know, thinking about it now, you know, Gambit is there, right?
Love Gambit.
Cable's there. You know, it's kind of like, wow, these characters had just popped up maybe a year ago, 2 years prior to that. Yeah. You know, so, I mean, man, to put them in right away, I was like, wow, that's pretty amazing. You know?
I can even remember watching, like, the Genosha episode where they go, that I was able at that time to pick up. And at that time, it was probably based on, like... You know, I probably hadn't read a lot of comics with those characters in them, but I had seen them in, like, the X-Men cards. Yeah, because
I was going to say, like, Gambit is, like, very fresh.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Cable is very fresh. Yeah. You know?
But, like, in that Genosha episode, we see, like, Warpath. We see,
Yeah, you see a lot of the mutants.
North Star.
Yeah.
Because they're just, like, kind of there.
Yeah, Genosha, they all got
Pyro.
Captured. Yeah.
Yeah, they got captured. And I was like, I remember being like, oh, damn.
Yeah, now that we know, right, we're like, holy shit, there's, like, so many mutants.
But I had remember knowing who they were based on the cards. Because I was like, those are the cards you'd get. But you're like, who's this guy? You know what I mean? So, but it was cool to see them in the cartoon. And, of course, I had some knowledge from that very old 80s X-Men cartoon.
Yeah, with the
like the very Australian Wolverine. Terrible. Which, oddly enough, then he gets played by an Australian and still, you know, by Hugh Jackman.
I didn't even think about that.
But he sounded very, the guy that whoever did the voice in that old 80s one sounded very Aussie. But that was a very cool one because it had, like, Pyro came out. It was kind of like the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants was kind of it, you know what I mean? And I want to say that somehow that game that everybody loved, that arcade game, AA, had to have been based or tied into that 80s version as well, because they seem to share similarities in the animation and things like that. So, you know, but again, that was like the last time we'd seen the animated X-Men until this time. So, but yeah.
Well, just, I mean, there had been other ones between that ending and this one. You know, they did X-Men Evolution.
Right.
You know, Wolverine and the X-Men.
Wolverine and the X-Men, yeah, where they kind of make him the leader, right?
Yeah, because, like, Cyclops, Professor X, and Jean are gone. Something like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you ever catch any of those other versions?
Not really.
Yeah, I didn't really see either. Yeah.
I didn't want to. Like, at that time, I was like, man, what is this? Like, because after seeing this one, just how it was, just how serious it was, how the tone and everything, seeing anything after this kind of sucked.
Yeah, and then, too, you know, like, how the animation style changed so much, like, where...
Yeah, because it's weird. Like, when you do Batman, right, and then you do Batman Beyond, it wasn't that much of a stretch between those two. You know what I mean? But, man, they didn't keep the same tone at all with these other ones. I was a little disappointed.
Yeah, and I get it. You're trying to kind of, like, you know, redo the show for another generation of youth. But, man, I just couldn't get through that animation style, which seems so, like...
It was at that time.
Put together,
It was
at
that time that was going.
Yeah, very blocky and, like, you know, like, really these sharp edges. And I was just like, man, it doesn't look, you know... I mean, this one, the 92 to 96...
Yeah, they did really good.
Yeah, it's like, even as I was rewatching it right now, I was like, man, they really put a lot of detail in the background, you know, the shading. Yeah. It almost looks like you're watching, like, a living comic book, you know? So, what else, Double A? You got some favorite episodes that stick out to you?
Yeah, a lot of the time episodes, the Time Fugitives, One Man's Worth, the Beyond Good and Evil. I remember me and my brother Will were really, really into that Beyond Good and Evil because it had so many mutants.
Yeah.
Psylocke came out in that one.
Okay.
You had a lot of the psychics.
Oh, cool.
That you saw, like, White Queen was there, Strife was there.
Nice.
At the end, you know, not knowing at that time, but then figuring out King comes out at the end, but in his Immortus
look. That's right.
Because they're almost like in his area.
Yeah.
Like Apocalypse somehow kicked King out of his like home base. you know? So
this is where they're running around in that, like, time bridge, right?
Yes.
And that guy's like, come on, come on, come
yeah,
on,
gotta go. That's Immortus.
Yes, yeah. Yes, I think Kane. You had me rewatch yeah. that one recently when we
yeah,
when
so I was like, Kane. Whoa, like, being blown away. I'm like, holy shit, that was Kane. Like,
that is pretty cool.
Like, damn. You know, the sinister plots, you know, the nasty boys, him and his nasty boys, you know, yes. getting Jean and Cyclops, his obsession with them.
Right, you right. know?
Yeah, I mean, there are so many good ones.
Yeah,
even Cyclops going to that weird small town. I don't know if you remember that one.
I don't know if I remember that
yeah,
one.
Yeah, he like goes off to like a small town. I think he's after like the Phoenix Saga.
Okay.
And he goes to like this weird fucking town that's like has like a cult leader. And,
no shit.
And he breaks him down. You know, he.
That's pretty cool. No, I can't remember seeing that
yeah.
one. But yeah, I mean, like, you know, we talked about some of them, but like Cold Vengeance, you know, Intermagneto, and I know yeah. that those are all like season one, but I also remember like vividly watching, you know, the Phoenix Saga, you know, seeing Gladiator arrive. And,
oh, man.
And
I remember because like I didn't know Gladiator, right? Mm-hmm. I didn't know She-Hulk. So when I saw yeah. Gladiator, I was like, holy shit. Like when he just tossed his juggernaut, I was like,
yeah.
whoa.
Or first he kind of gives him that punch, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And he just stands there. You're like, oh, shit, who's this guy?
I was
guy,
like, oh, you know? Man. So I've always been a Gladiator fan because of that cartoon.
Yeah.
So anytime Gladiator is, like, in the comics, I usually try to pick it up. But the juggernaut episodes were really good, especially
yes.
when that nerd takes his power. Remember when that nerd takes the Cinerac?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that idiot becomes Juggernaut, and, like, Professor X is going into his head, Juggernaut's head, and you know they're still fighting in the
right.
fucking head.
Remember, he goes to that dance club and he's like, in that club,
yeah.
he's like trying to like meet
and
girls.
He's like
and stuff.
Fucking jacked. He's like super jacked, and he knocks like Wolverine and Cyclops out of the way.
Yeah, you know, and of course, like famously, like years later, those episodes would spawn that, you know, I'm the Juggernaut, bitch, you know what I mean? Like, that became a whole other thing. You know, like, there are so many memes now too. You know, just talking, just thinking about it. I was thinking of and real quick, just to, like, you know, show some more of the character, but, like, you know, Gambit became my second favorite good guy.
Same here. He's always been my number two guy from the X-Men.
And I felt, too, that he was a guy that, like, he had some back talk to for Cyclops.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, he was like, man, you know, fuck you, whatever,
yeah,
you know?
Like, yeah, it's like, fuck this dude.
But, you know, just so cool with the cards and, you know, always trying to, like, hit on Rogue, you know?
And it was always cool because at that time, too, like, in the comics, him and Wolverine always smoked.
Yeah,
you know, which I mean, I don't like smoking, but
right.
I mean, it just looked cool that them two,
yeah,
these two fucking guys are doing it, you know. And Wolverine always calling him Cajun, you know.
Yes,
like, you know, I always thought that was cool. And I mean, he was just a badass. Gambit's just a really badass character.
The classic episode, I don't remember when it happens, if it's in like the first couple episodes, but when they're playing basketball, right?
Yeah,
with Jubilee,
yeah.
You know what I mean? And Wolverine, the
yeah,
ball,
she's like, no power, and he's like, Gambit, a natural athlete,
yeah. He just had so much charisma, you know.
Yeah,
I mean?
He really did.
I think this cartoon is what spawned like him that solo series for a little bit.
I'd have to have,
and it
know.
Makes me think too, like, damn, like, what happened like Gambit in comics? Like, is he
just
yeah.
that, you know, I mean, Claremont leaves, Jim Lee leaves,
right,
you
right.
know, and it's just a whole bunch of other people kind of, you know, taking over the characters and turning them, you know, like, there's so many characters that you find later on that got like, whoa, that didn't seem like that was where they were going in the origin, you know,
right.
in the beginning of the characters. You know, Cable goes off totally this way.
Yeah.
He's supposed to be the guy that comes back from the future to tell Xavier and Magneto, both of you are wrong on what you're doing.
Mm.
I'm going to tell you how to fix it.
Okay.
But then he follows Xavier, too. So it's kind of like,
yeah.
okay, well, they took him in a fucking different direction. And, you know, Gambit, too, he was this badass,
right?
You know, Cajun kind of loner that loved Rogue, though. And
yeah.
then they took him off somewhere.
I know. I think last thing I heard, like, of him in comic-wise, he was, like, one of the Horsemen of Apocalypse.
Yeah,
and
they had,
like
Beast, too. Like, recently, Beast is, like, becoming the Dark Beast of the Age of Apocalypse, where he's doing,
jeez.
Like, a lot of bad shit, and I'm like, what the fuck's going on? Like, what happened to these guys? Like,
yeah, that's not
what?
Good. That's not my X-Men, you know what
yeah,
I mean?
I'm like,
so...
what is all this? Like, man.
I'm like, do we know what we're doing with the characters at this point? I don't know, but
Cyclops has, you know, been with Jean, with White Queen, and
yeah.
he's been kind of, like, borderline Magneto kind of attitude now, and I don't know. They just took him, like, in all these weird directions.
Right.
You know what I mean?
You know, I think it's fine to kind of explore that stuff in, like, terms
sure,
of, like...
but, I mean, how
know.
Is it that Claremont kept everything
right.
great for 17 years?
Yeah.
Keeping these characters the same way for 17 years,
mm-hmm.
mind you. And it's the top book for that long.
Mm-hmm.
And then these other people grab it and they want to put their little marks on it.
yeah.
fuck everything up.
I would even say that. Would you say that Fabian Nessens, do you think he did a good job too?
He's actually a really good writer.
Yeah,
I actually do enjoy his writing on X-Force and X-Men. I enjoy his work, and they kind of when I was kind of reading it, because he had a hand in the Executioner song and Age of Apocalypse. They kept them pretty much the same way, almost, that Claremont had. It wasn't until, like, maybe the late 90s, 2000s is when they took them to this new direction.
Yeah, I mean,
because the 90s, if you see the 90s, it's not really that much of a difference. Like, all throughout, even the Onslaught years, you know who is kind of still X-Men. You know
I remember reading some of that stuff, and I was still like, okay, I'm able to follow easily. Yeah, you know
still,
what I mean?
So, still, everyone had the same traits. You know what I mean? So, yeah.
There's a great story that I remember, one of these books, I'd love to pick it up again if I run into it, but I think the artist at that time is that Joe Madureira. And, you know, he kind of draws them a little bit cartoony, but it kind of worked for the X-Men because it reminded me of the series. But he fights Sabretooth or whatever, like in the X-Mansion. He kind of has like a one-on-one with him, which cool.
I have that comic.
That one? Yes. I mean, you know, like again, for me, like some people would say that guy's art is kind of cartoony, but I was like, well, it kind of works with, you know, this series.
See, my thing too is I enjoyed Andy Kubert's work after he took over from Jim Lee. I didn't think he strayed too much from the Jim Lee, but he had his own little touches.
Exactly. You know, and I love Kubert on the X-Men, and his Wolverine stuff is great, you know. Because, I mean, I was hanging on for a while, you know what I mean, in the books.
Like you said, if you look at throughout the 90s, they still are pretty much almost the same characters.
Yeah.
It's not until, like I say, Grant Morrison, I guess, took over.
Maybe that's what it was.
And then that's when they started doing everything.
And I know that this most recent, I think I was telling you, we talked about it, with that Powers of X, House of X, I tried to get into it because I heard it was going to be good, and I was like, I'm so lost. I mean, and I was like, am I not smart enough for this anymore?
Well, it's weird. Like, all of a sudden, you see, like, Xavier, Magneto, Apocalypse, Sinister, Exodus, Mystique, they're all hanging out. It's like, what?
Yeah.
Like, what? Like, no.
It's weird.
No, you can't
it's
do that.
It's definitely weird.
Yeah.
Lane says, Gambit. Hey, I had such an over-the-top Cajun accent. It's funny. Bruce Potter voiced him. He says, I knew him as a Kwai Chai Kane's son. Kwai Chai Kane's son in Kung Fu, The Legend of Nah, no shit. Nice. Okay. Very cool. Yeah, definitely an over-the-top accent. But I kind of feel like it worked for the time.
I really think Double it did.
Because it was like, oh, I knew he was from somewhere else. You know what I mean? So, and I feel like Gambit had ties to Madripoor and stuff like that, too. He kind of ran in some of the circles Wolverine ran in. So he was a little bit, like, mysterious, too. And
it's funny. Big time. I don't think they started explaining a lot of his shit, because even in... He's a main player in Bishop's storyline, remember? Where Bishop thinks he's the traitor of the X-Men.
Yes.
Where eventually, you know, you find out it's Onslaught. But even then, it ran from, like, that period to all the way to Onslaught.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then, you know, his you know, they say he's the one that brought the Marauders together. Remember for Sinister?
Yeah.
He's the one that brings them all together. But he didn't know they were going to kill the Morlocks.
Right. That's right. I forgot they had a past.
Yeah, and him and Sinister have a past. And apparently Sinister, too, is the one that helped him bring his power down.
Okay.
Because his power was kind of getting out of control, Gambit, where it was just, like, coming out of him.
Yeah.
So he asked Mr. Sinister if he can help him, and Sinister does. He does help him. He helps him bring his power down to where he can control it. So
interesting.
I was like, wow, that's a lot of shit, like, right there. And then, I don't know if you remember, too, when Xavier's going into Gambit's head, but, like, Ghost Rider is there. And I was like, well, what the fuck? Like,
damn.
Like, what the hell went into him to, like...
No shit, right? Cross that comes out in the cartoon?
Yeah, it's like... Oh, wow. It's the Bishop episode. First time where he's like, he's a traitor. You know, and then Xavier looks into his head, and I think there's, like, an image of Ghost Rider there. I was like, holy shit.
Well, because for a long time, that was, like, the running backstory in X-Men, right? Was like, you know, that's what Bishop had came to stop.
Yeah, Bishop had came because they were supposedly a traitor that turned on the X-Men.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, and that's what kind of caused all the Onslaught stuff to come to fruition. So, and I remember I didn't know all
they
that.
They played with that storyline for a long time. I was like, damn, that storyline's still going.
Which another thing that was cool. I was like, man, look at, like, why aren't these writers today doing stuff like that or whatever, you know?
Yeah.
So, interesting, but definitely different.
But even too, like, even a character like Bishop, he had just came out too.
Yeah,
he had just been created
in the 90s. He
was around, like, Jim Lee had created Gambit, Liefeld had created Cable, and then Will Spataccio had created Bishop.
Yeah,
so it was like, man, these Image guys, they were doing a lot of the Image stuff, you know, at that time. So
very cool. Yeah, and you're right, because this cartoon came out in 92.
Yeah, Bishop had, those were all in the 90s.
Yeah, very awesome. anything that maybe you didn't like about the show, AA, that to you felt like hammy or cheesy or could have done
without? I don't know, because, man, the Magneto stuff was always pretty fucking intense.
Yeah.
All the time. Especially when he had that first voice. I know they changed it a little bit and then they brought him back.
Okay.
But his voice was great. The Iceman story was cool because we saw X Factor. That was cool too. I don't know if you remember that one where Iceman comes back.
No.
And they actually show Havoc and Cyclops engaging.
Yeah,
badass. But their powers aren't working with each other.
Right.
Like Havoc is shooting at Cyclops and Cyclops shooting at him and they're like, what the fuck?
It doesn't work.
Yeah.
But they don't know they're brothers at that time.
They don't know.
Yeah, I do remember that.
Which is weird because in the comics it's pretty established. They know they're brothers.
They played with some things, I think, a little bit in this cartoon too. Like, you know, the whole, like, Wolverine knows of Sabretooth, but the X-Men don't, or whatever. You're like, well, when did everybody hook up? You kind of don't really know.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So,
I think the only one I was kind of always kind of frustrated about was just how long the Phoenix saga had lasted. Because it's the first five parts where she becomes Phoenix first, and then they're dealing with all that. And then it's kind of like the Hellfire Club comes in, and then it's like another five episodes. I remember thinking, like, fuck, like, episode one, okay, 22 minutes, shit. Second one, it was like, damn, it was like a whole month of like just Dark Phoenix. And I was like, I was kind of like tired of this series. I was like, man, they could really like
push
this one
up
a little bit here.
Tighten it up.
Yeah. But it's probably still the best adaptation of the Dark Phoenix storyline.
Yeah, I think
honestly.
So. Yeah.
I can't really, I don't know if there's any complaints. I mean, man, Apocalypse was great. Magneto was great. Mr. Sinister was great.
He had some great moments, man. Apocalypse beating the X-Men, too. I can remember him, too, telling him, you know, you're no closer than the Babylonians with their swords and fire sticks, you know, just mashing freaking, I think it's Angel or Rogue into the ceiling with that big man. And I was like, I remember watching that thinking, like, I was like, this guy's unstoppable.
I know, I was thinking that, too. I was like, who the fuck is this?
I was like,
it looks like you need the Avengers to take this guy out.
Yeah, I was like, damn. That guy can't get beat. I was like, it looks like they were in the weeds. I was like, the X-Men are getting their asses kicked right now.
And then like the Omega Red story was cool. You know, the Weapon X lies in videotape.
Yes.
Where it's Wolverine, Silver Fox, Maverick, and Sabretooth.
Yes.
They all go back to Weapon X.
And they actually made the figures off of them where they're in there. Like the gear,
that was
right?
So cool.
That was so cool. I remember that one, the Wolverine figure had like a little like eye thing you could swipe over and then like covered his eyes.
And
it was like,
Sabretooth.
I was like, you gotta have
that. Forget it, kid. They're done for.
Yeah.
Come on, let's go.
And I was actually pretty familiar with that stuff because I had read a lot of
the Jim Lee.
It was that
little storyline.
And the Larry Hama X-Men, too, because he was Wolverine.
Yeah.
The Larry Hama Wolverine.
The yellow cover.
Yes, he had talked a lot about that in there, so that was definitely cool. Real quick, some comments. Lane says, I love the voice of Magneto.
Voice was so menacing.
Yeah, absolutely. Man, what are you waiting for? You know what I mean? Like, it was just so cool. I was like, you know, then even that stuff, too. You know, Beast was another great character with all his great quotes.
Yes. I mean, very soft. Soft-spoken, right?
Yeah. I didn't even know some of those writers were, like, realists. I was like, oh, he's quoting, like, real poetry and shit. Like, real, you know, philosophy. And things like, Beast was so, like, he was teaching kids, man. I was like, that guy was teaching kids for sure. Lane says, I am the Apocalypse. Yeah, very cool. Carrie in the house says, Carrie, dying to see the new X-Men episodes. X-Men for life. Yes, I know X-Men. Carrie's
a
big,
you know,
Rogue
fan. Now that I'm thinking about it, maybe I was like, some of the lineups. I was like, you know, I know Jubilee was kind of new, but I was kind of at Morph.
Mm-hmm.
But it was kind of like, man, really? Like, you take out Colossus and Nightcrawler, you know? Like, man, like Colossus would have been such a badass.
Yes.
I know he comes out in an episode,
right.
A few episodes, but still.
Like, some people we didn't get enough of,
like,
right?
Damn, like, man, we can never get Colossus. And he was, like, such a big part of the team for a long time.
And I think he was in that old 80s one I'm referring to, whatever.
Yeah,
he was cool. With the classic yellow red shoulder pads.
Yeah.
And I remember, too.
He's with the team from, like, 75 into, like, 92 when he joins the Acolytes.
Yeah, he comes out in giant size X-Men.
I mean, that's his first appearance.
From that run. So it's like, you know, and I know, like, our friend Holty Bear, show alumni and former host, is a huge Colossus fan.
Yeah, because Colossus is the one that fights Gladiator in the Shi'ar versus X-Men.
Ah, okay.
Colossus is the one that goes one-on-one against Colossus, not Rogue.
Nice.
Yeah.
I mean, how does he fare?
Gladiator so beats his ass. Because, like, Colossus, they always make it, like, seem like, for, like, with anything, he's, like, below Thing.
Yeah.
Like, he's in that category where he's not as strong as Thing. Hulk, Surfer.
No,
you know,
definitely not.
He's like with Spider-Man. Or a little bit stronger than Spider-Man.
Right.
Kind of like with Venom.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. But he was able to kind of go toe-to-toe with Juggernaut a little bit, right?
Yeah, but even then, they made Juggernaut such a...
Stronger.
Yeah, because even then, like, Juggernaut was going over to Hulk. So, you know, right. he's going to challenge Hulk.
And, yeah.
Yeah, Colossus probably ain't going to be...
You know, I did like his iteration in Deadpool. You know, I thought they gave...
I thought
kind of an accurate, like okay, he's Russian. You got that right. He looks cool.
He looked big,
Yeah, I was like, that's how he's kind of supposed to look. You know what I mean?
But they never want to. They never want to get Colossus though. They never like even in the movies. Like man, I don't know if you remember, but there was a pop in X2 when he changes. Like I remember the theater I was in. Armored up pretty hard. I was like, man, Colossus. You know?
Yeah, that was a really cool effect. And you know, even that part where he's like, I can help, and he's like, yeah, keep them safe. Yeah, I'm like,
and then you're thinking maybe Last Stand too. Like, man, finally he's going to be in the team, and I don't think he really is.
No. That's a very strong point to make AA about if there was a weakness in the show. And it's so funny you mentioned Morph because man, for me, I just fucking hated that character. I was so annoyed by Morph. And then I found out that
he was created for the show.
Yeah. Like, oh, okay. You know, just the fact that you know that. That fucking dumb part, you know what I mean, where he's like, watch it, Wolverine. I'm like, you do know his powers are to heal, right? Like, I'm like, how fucking dumb are you? Like, I just remember being like, I just did not like him. I was so annoyed by the Morph character. I hated when he came back and wanted vengeance. I'm like, you're a fuck up. I'm like, you deserved what you got. You know what I mean? I was like, hey, why were you even on? Yeah. Exactly. I was like, why were you even on the squad? There's
this corpse in there.
Sometimes I was like, you know what? There's where Cyclops' mistakes were. I was like, weak leadership on that part. Like, what did this guy fucking uniform for? I was like, this guy needed more training, clearly. I was like, I mean, number one, he should be in the field in that sense. You know, what were his powers beyond that?
And it, nothing. It's like my brother Will would always say, he changes.
Right.
That's it. He doesn't have their power.
Yeah.
He just changes.
Yeah. And weren't you telling me recently, AA, that now Mystique does get the powers?
Now she can. Now they actually made it to where she can change her DNA.
Oh, to match.
To be a man if she wanted to be.
Okay. But, like, if she changes into Cyclops, can she shoot optic glass? No, there
shouldn't be. That shouldn't still be.
That's weird. Yeah, it shouldn't be.
Because it's like, he said that, too, about X-Men, the first one. He's like, okay, you can change it to Wolverine, but you shouldn't have adamantium claws.
Right,
like
definitely you not.
Shouldn't.
Yeah, that's
that was never a part of your thing.
Or also, if I like,
she was always as an infiltrator. You know what I mean? She could change.
Yeah,
like she was Magneto's kind of like secret agent almost, where she can blend in, and she was so smart. That she can, you know, hack into shit. That was her.
I mean, like, I get it, too, where, like, if she's taking over, like, you know, looking like one of the senators or people in power to manipulate things for the mutants, that makes perfect sense. I'm like, that's the way to use Mystique, whatever, you know, but having her get the powers is kind of weird, because if it shouldn't be. If she first encounters Wolverine and doesn't know he even has claws, how can she produce claws that she doesn't really have?
Yeah, because my brother was like, well, then it should be, like, her skin that's, like...
Right,
growing into claws.
So, like, just, if you were to, it doesn't if make to sense. Slice her,
then it should be cutting off something.
Like, like when he does, three fingers down.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
Where you could just be all over the place with that, man. I'm telling you, it's fucking strange, whatever. But a few comments here. One more. This one, okay.
Just like you were saying.
Oh, he was in part of the X-Men special meant to launch an X-Men show. Yes, that's right. That's what I was talking about. I always forget that's what it's called, Pride of the X-Men, because it's Kitty Pride in that one. She's like the Jubilee. Like I always thought they put a character to lead you
in. See, that would have been kind of cool if you had Kitty in there instead of Jubilee.
Yeah.
Because Kitty was so much... I think Kitty is such a much better character than Jubilee.
Yeah.
You know, her powers are cooler and... Wolverine does actually teach her to become a badass.
Yes.
Fighter and Wolverine.
And she has a little something with Colossus too, right? Yeah, Colossus.
Which is kind of controversial at the time.
Because she's a little young, right?
Yeah, she was like 13 or 14 when Colossus was like kind of like, hey, we should be together. And Colossus is like in his 20s at that point. Yeah, that's why I was like, huh. That was weird that they wrote that.
She's pulling the Elvis and the Jerry Lee Lewis.
Damn.
He ain't nothing but a hound dog.
I'm grooming her.
We still love you, Colossus.
Grooming her.
Hey, you know, I saw some recent shit with her with Shadowcat where she was doing some cool shit with the powers. I think it was in the comics. I think it was like one of those things that came up in my stream and I was just like reading through it and she was like fucking like phasing people into walls and shit, leaving them there and they're all
That's
like,
what I'm saying.
Up.
Her powers are so much cooler.
Like, yeah, like those powers are like she was. Like,
I never understood Jubilees.
Like, yeah. Well,
were these? How strong was that shit that she was supposed to be shooting at?
I thought it looked whack. It really did. Yeah, it was like, and then they call it like fireworks or some shit. I'm like, well,
it
what
does.
I mean, don't mind you. I wouldn't want to get hit with fireworks. We've been around enough fireworks exploding. That's pretty fucking scary. But okay, maybe it is cool.
But there is so much you could have done with Kitty. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I saw this in one of those scenes. It had to be from a comic, unless I saw it somewhere else. But yeah, like Double A, she literally like grabs a guy, yes, phases through the floor, uh-huh, and leaves him halfway through, yes, the floor. And I was like, holy shit, yeah, that's fucking, like, she's using the powers badass. Yeah. Like, that phasing power, mm-hmm, will fuck you up, you know?
Yeah.
Where are we at, Double A? Here?
Go back up.
One more? Oh, shit, sorry.
Right there.
Right here. Kara says, I love when Rogue fought Juggernaut. Yeah, that's a classic moment. Definitely loved seeing them go, like, two powerhouses go ahead. And they actually showed her origin in this
yeah, with the Captain Marvel.
Yes.
With Carol.
Which was pretty cool. Yeah, with Carol, I remember that being like, oh, uh-huh, wow, they showed that. Because, yeah, I had always remember reading it on the, did you know, on the card. Yeah. Like, mm-hmm, she got her powers from holding on to too long to Captain Marvel. So we'd love to see, like, Anna Paquin get a hold of, what's her name?
Brie Larson.
Brie Larson, and just absorb all of her power. Lane says, I remember when Colossus became Juggerlossom and became a servant of Sidorak and had Juggernaut, whoa, powers. Damn, that's pretty wild.
Okay.
Is that in the comics, Lane? If so, yeah, if so, that sounds for the guys. It is, even in the new animated series, they're not having him join. We get Sunspot. Why? Bring in Colossus.
I never understood.
I agree, too. Understand. Bring in Colossus. You know what I mean? Like, you know, he's foreign, he's Russian, you're mixing it up, you know? I mean, I like it. Kara says, Wolverine, pull back. He says, oh, I like Morph. No, Kara, Morph sucks. Lane says, whoa, years, Jubilee was a vampire, what, and had a baby that became a dragon. Wow.
What?
Is it the dragon that hung out with, what's
Magic?
Her name?
Magic? Colossus' yeah, sister?
I remember when Jubilee was one of the mutants that was part of the No More Mutants, that, like,
oh,
she didn't,
yeah,
she lost the powers,
yeah,
or whatever,
right,
and it was like, that was like a thing or whatever. She didn't have powers anymore, you know? So, I don't know. I remember her also being in that, remember that Generation X show that was,
yeah,
like short-lived and,
yeah,
and crummy? But yeah, and her too, she was kind of a character people popped for that was coming out like in the X-Men movies,
that's
like,
right,
as a student, but
that's
she,
right,
just was there in the background, you know?
And it's because of the cartoon, obviously.
She lost her powers and became a vampire. Okay. Lane says, yes, it was in the comics. He had a weird Juggernaut helmet look combined with his metal skin. It was stupid. It can't be stupider than Frank Castle being a Frankenstein. That was fucking horrible. And then, yeah, Lane confirms, yeah, she lost her powers and became a vampire. Okay. All right. They're like, we got to have Jubilee have powers, make her a vampire.
Wow.
How about this classic moment, Double A right here? So memed, so copied, but man. Wolverine pining over. I always felt it was kind of weird that he had a picture of them as a couple. Like, I'm like,
I guess he had to, because I bet you Jean gave him that picture and he was like, I'm gonna put it up just so she won't see.
Okay,
you know what I mean?
Okay, that is.
But then he was like, I had enough, and he was just like, fuck Cyclops.
I mean, in your moments alone, just fold it in half. Wolverine, like, oh, I don't want to be looking at Cyclops.
Right, but then she's gonna see the bed.
Damn. Or she comes into his room and she's like, hey, what the fuck? You know? I know, but I'm like, hey, here's a picture of me and my boyfriend. Or whatever. You know, like, yeah, thanks.
Damn.
You know I clearly have feelings for you, right?
Damn.
I don't know if Gene was fucking totally on point with that shit, you know what I mean? So, but yeah, classic meme. Again, probably the greatest X-Men villain, or not even probably, it just is, right?
Yeah.
I would say,
yes.
You know, Magneto.
Yes.
You know, we were watching this at a time in our lives, right, Double A, where maybe we didn't really understand, you know, all of, like, you know, bigotry and hatred and, mm-hmm, things like that. But, man, this cartoon really did,
yeah,
make it easy to understand. You know, like, I felt always really compelled by Magneto's arguments. I was like, well, they treat them like shit. Like,
Claremont did a really good job of where you wanted to follow Magneto, but you also wanted to follow Xavier in his dialogues that he would write.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I always love that about the X-Men.
Yeah.
About them, too.
And I think the cartoon, portrayed it beautifully as
it
well.
Really did.
It made it understandable,
it really,
to kids. You know, it made it be like, you know, they treat us badly and we're more powerful than them. Why are we letting that happen? You know what I mean? You know, to take a line back again from Deacon Frost, man, these people are our food.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, now, mind you, the mutants aren't eating
funny.
The humans,
that
but it's kind of like, why am I letting you push me around, kick me in the dirt, put my face in mud? You know, treat me like a subhuman. You're not even treating me like an equal, and I'm more powerful than you, literally. You know, Magneto wasn't going
to happen.
This is a
guy who could crush the world if he really wanted to.
Yeah.
He can,
yeah,
shut down the world,
I mean,
if
that,
he wanted to.
That EMP he does in,
yeah,
Fatal Attractions,
yeah,
is like, oh, he fucked everything up.
Yeah.
Planes were dropping down out of the sky.
Yep.
Hospitals shut down.
Uh-huh.
I was like, oh, Magneto fucked everybody. You know what I mean? I would love to see Fatal Attractions in the animation. Mm. I know, it's so,
ooh,
dark, right? Yeah.
Brutal. Brutal stuff.
That'd be so cool, though, man. I feel like, are they making this AA for new watchers, or is this for us? They gotta be making it for us. That has to be for us, right? Yeah. I mean, like, kids didn't watch this one, you know what I mean? Like, they watched probably that one you said, X-Men, Wolverine and the X-Men, you know what I mean? Or, so I'm like, dude, give us what we want, man. Give us the animated Fatal Attractions. Magneto ripping the adamantium off Wolverine's bones? I mean, I was like, oof, man, as a Wolverine fan, that hurt. I was like, fuck.
When Magneto finally just hanging off of him.
Yeah. Well, he fucking gives him that rowdy. Yeah. And he's like, man, I always fucking took it easy on you. Mm-hmm. And you're like, oh, wow.
Yep.
You know, I didn't think you had that kind of compassion, Magneto. He was like, you know, I'm fucking done playing with your ass. And that is what, like, in the halls of X-Men, you know, characters, it's like, for me, it's always Wolverine and then Magneto. You know what I mean? Like, but when it comes to good guys, it's Wolverine and Gambit. But, you know, like, good guys wise. But yeah, Magneto is definitely like the top of the bad guys. Magneto is the official Just Another Friday Night, you know, a villain. Yes. Because, you know, again, too, it's hard to not like a villain who you kind of like, well, he's making a really good point. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, you know, what are you gonna fucking say?
But at the same time, you're making him just like Hitler. You know what I mean?
Right.
At the exact same time.
He is becoming the thing he hates the most.
Which was, man, genius on Claremont's part.
Mm-hmm. You know, oh, absolutely. Genius. Yeah, yeah. Oh, what do they say? Either you die the hero or live long enough to see yourself become the villain. Exactly. So there you go. Batman, right?
Christopher Nolan.
Where am I at? Christopher Nolan. Yeah, where am I at? Double
hero. Go down. Right there.
Right there. Lane says, he says, I see you guys skipped off my Hodo Toys comment there. Oh, did I miss that, Lane?
I guess sorry. So.
I don't know. What did it say, Lane? bring us back in.
Keep going up. Just keep going up.
There's a lot of stuff coming in here.
Oh, right there. Right there.
This one? Oh. Yeah. Look at this. Have you seen the Hono comic book based off the figures? I know you must be looking at...
No, I haven't.
I have not, Lane. So, yeah, that'd be something to
I'm not an action figure collector anymore. I really haven't been. So, I mean, I really don't see those very much.
Lane, shoot me a DM with those because I'd like to see them. I haven't, you know, I collect, you know, not like the level of you guys, but I do, you know, and I am missing X-Men from my little run of things I do happen to buy, and I would love to have something really cool, you know, Wolverine and Magneto for sure. So let's see.
And they're right there.
Lane then says, if you wanted to see a weird Magneto, go see Magneto's episode in Spider-Man and the Amazing Friends. Boy, that Magneto is way different. I don't remember that, but I remember I always loved when they would cross over.
You know I really like, did,
in those
too.
Old cartoons, yes. And then even in these modern
crossovers. Come on, it's what we want. We're not seeing more.
Because the X-Men did come out in the animated Spider-Man.
Yes, they did.
Yeah, and I think, did Spidey come out in theirs? No, I don't think so.
No, Spider-Man still has the one that had, like, Iron Man come out.
Yeah.
Doctor Strange came out.
Yeah.
Captain America came out. Storm came out, I believe.
I think I even saw, like, Rogue. Rogue?
Did he bring Rogue too?
Maybe.
I think they did. Yes.
Yeah, I saw like some imagery and I was like, oh, I don't remember that. And I was like, I need to rewatch that series too. Shit.
Yeah, so Spider-Man had a shitload of like really cool cameos.
Okay. Yeah. Were there other cool cameos in this one? I know we talked about Cap, but were there other ones that came out that you remember doing? Not X-Universe related, but from the outside world? I mean, obviously we just mentioned Captain Marvel, Ghost Rider, you know. They didn't get no Daredevil, right? Nothing like that happened?
No, that was another Spider-Man.
Mm-hmm.
The Daredevil one.
Spidey's going to always get the goods, man. He's Spider-Man.
And that's a really good two-parter, too, that Daredevil one. That's a really cool two-part. No, I think that was it.
Okay. Real quick here, Lane says, I remember all the stuff that Magneto does in Ultimatum from the Ultimate Universe, something truly amazingly awful. Yeah, I remember some of that stuff, too. Kara says, I always like the soap opera love stories with the characters. Yes, that really, I think...
I mean, it's all part of the X-Men.
Yeah.
Like, it always has been during Claremont's run.
But
it always was.
You know, that was something they probably could have left out, thinking that the audience was going to be primarily male. But it was great. It was great that we got to see the Jean, Cyclops, Wolverine, Love Triangle. It was great that we got to see Gambit and Rogues. You know, Gambit continually pursuing her, knowing that, you know, it could be, you know, fatal. Death for him. Yeah. Even, don't they even get a little bit into Moira and Xavier?
Yeah.
And a little bit into
Lalandra and Xavier.
You know, which is cool. For you know, get to see Professor X, you know what I mean? You know, who, you know, you kind of see is sometimes kind of stiff, you know what I mean? And you're like, oh, he's a little bit of a stiff in these in these shows, but you know, I mean, it's Xavier, you know what I mean? So I always love seeing the flashbacks when he'd be able to walk around and shit like that. I was like, oh wow, what, you know, you're kind of like, what happened, you know what I mean? So it's very cool stuff. Let me see where am I at here real quick. Oh, sorry, guys. And then Lane says, he goes, trust me, Double A, you will see these and hit the over button. Wow, okay.
I mean, that was cool.
And he says, oh, no, Spider-Man and the Amazing Friends.
No, yeah,
I remember.
No, we know.
Yeah, for sure. I think those are, you can watch those on Disney Plus.
Yes, too. You can.
I watch those sometimes.
Would come out every now and then on, I forgot what channel, but... Because I remember I saw a string of those one time. I forgot where I saw them. Before the streaming services came out.
That was where I always loved the classic Iceman, the Ice Up. Because
what a weird
Ice
three.
Huh?
What a weird three.
Yeah. So. Iceman, the Firestar, and they had their
own new character. Base.
Right. Oh, yeah, she was made just for the cartoon.
Yeah, and then, you know, they all stayed at Aunt May's place. I was like...
Yeah, that's where they had the hidden wall, right? I don't think I realized they were at Aunt May's house. Where's that universe? I want more of that universe. He says they had Spider-Man, Firestar, Ice, villains like Doc versus Doctor
Doom. Yeah, they had everybody.
Magneto, Swarm, Sandman, Green Goblin, Loki. It was like, you guys are a little bit out of your depth with some of those villains. Yeah, I remember some of those old Spider-Mans where he's like, him and Doctor Doom are mixing it up.
Spider-Man was the only one that could really ever get off the ground, though.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, it's weird.
Yeah, and I thought some of those iterations of Doom were pretty solid, actually. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, of course he got bested, but I mean, it was like, you know, he was shooting shit, and he had a cool, creepy voice. I was like, damn, that's
the Doom bots. Yeah, that robotic voice, right?
Yeah, I was like, damn, dude was doing pretty good over here, you know? He says, hell, they had Submariner, Captain America, Shaun the She-Devil, Doctor Strange. Okay, talking about the X-Men one, right? Who else was in there? He says, versus the chameleon of all villains.
Hey, chameleon.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. It's like, damn, chameleon's there? Wolverine and Lady Deathstrike, yes, that was a good one, Kara. Good relationship there, yeah. Do they get into the Monaco stuff at all?
I don't think they talk about that.
But yeah. But Silver Fox, obviously that too, you know, the Wolverine's birthday stuff. And a lot of that stuff is pretty dark in the comics, but they were able to maintain it, you know, like get across the point. What do you always say, Double A? The spirit of it came through, I think. So wonderfully done by the people that were doing the X-Men cartoon at the time. Lane says, that was the series that had Aunt May's dog, Ms. Lion,
repeatedly
showing up. Damn, I need to watch some of those for sure. He says, and heck, Video Man as an enemy.
Especially, when, you know, during that time when arcades were just all the rage.
Yeah,
you know,
so, yeah. I think Video Man will be a hero now.
It would be.
We're finding out. Don't get rid of your physical media, everybody. Yeah. I don't know, Double A. I don't got a lot else.
Yeah, it's just, man, you know, it's just a really exciting cartoon. All five seasons are on Disney Plus. You can watch them real quick. They're only like 22 minutes.
Yeah.
And get ready for X-Men 97 coming out Wednesday.
And the fact that you've seen some of it, you know, already, it's like you can watch it. Like, I put it on my phone while I'm, like, brushing my teeth or when I'm, like, you know, I'm doing things I have in the background.
But the stories are so engaging still.
And I feel like it's more like how we're having the conversation now where we're saying things and then, like, things click into my memory and I'm like, oh, yeah, that. You know, oh, yeah, that. This is how we all feel right now. We're like Wolverine, like, damn, can't wait for that X-Men next week. Again, guys, you know that me and Double A will be watching and you know that we'll be covering it here on Just Another Friday Night. I love this series. Did you like it better than the Spider-Man?
It was kind of hard. Because at that time I really did like the Spider-Man series.
Mm-hmm. I loved it.
Because, man, that series was great too.
Yeah,
it had everything.
Yeah.
I mean, they had every villain on there and the cameo, I mean, the people that guest starred on that cartoon was fucking amazing. I mean, I don't know, because like I said, he had Iron Man, War Machine helping him against, like, Carnage and Venom. You know, and then the Secret Wars, he had all that great cast of characters. And you know, his kind of Spider-Verse, those last episodes where you see all the different Spider-Men, too, that was really cool, too.
And Double A, is that Spider-Man and this X-Men running at the same time?
I think Spider-Man came out in 94.
Okay.
So this one already had the 2 years.
And
but man, after seeing these X-Men, I mean, man, this X-Men show is just really, really good.
Oh,
the animation's good, and it's really serious.
Yeah, no doubt.
It's some serious shit. And they show some really nightmarish visions, futures, you know, so.
Anytime my nephew asks me stuff, and he's like, oh, you know, Uncle Charlie, do you have these comics? Do you know, like, you know, when is that? I said, you know what you should watch? You should watch the X-Men cartoon. I said, that's how I really learned. Batman, too. And that was at the same time, too, right?
Yes, it was.
So, I mean, talk about a golden age.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Cartoons.
I was like, man.
You know?
It was X-Men, Spider-Man, The Tick, you know, that were all coming out. You know, and then Batman would come out, like, during the week. And, yeah, I mean, man, what a great time.
Okay, Double A. So, before we get off here, but I got to say, if there was an animated cartoon comic book Mount Rushmore, who goes on there?
Well, this one for sure.
X-Men's on there. Batman the Animated Series for sure. Spider-Man?
Yeah, sure.
Superman?
Man, that Superman cartoon was really fun, too. That's actually kind of what made me a big fan of Superman's, was that cartoon.
Okay.
And
okay.
I learned so much about Darkseid from there.
Yeah.
Metallo. And Mixopitlick and Luthor. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would say, yeah.
Okay. For that's me, a pretty solid four right there. And I think I'm going to make our question on Spotify, guys. And don't forget that every time we do an episode, except I didn't do it last week, did I? No, yeah, I did do it last week. Every week, guys, we do an episode afterwards. If you watch us on Spotify, you can also watch us on Spotify. Not live, but after the replay, you can watch it there. I always put up a question or two questions. I think one of the questions is, what did you think of this episode? And the other question, I always put up something with like multiple choice. Like, so I'll probably put that up. Like, either I'll put, what was your favorite X-Men episode? Or I'll put, it's multiple choice. I'll more than likely put, like, what was your favorite, like, animated series, like, of this time? You know what I mean? Because I know that it's not based on a comic book, but, like, people loved Gargoyles, you know what I mean, at this time. Like,
Gargoyles,
it
too.
Was, like, wildly popular. Like you
said, The Tick was pretty popular,
oh, yeah, too. I loved that. I would laugh so much at that cartoon. I thought it was great.
And in this time, too. Well, you know what? They kind of came, their popularity kind of came when these shows were already kind of ending, but Pokemon was huge and Dragon Ball Z started taking over that period from like 96, 97.
Yeah.
But when these shows were already ending already by that point.
Now, AA, was Dragon Ball the cartoon already out?
They said it was. Yeah. Oh, yeah. From the 80s, it was.
Okay. So it's older than
these. So it's old. Okay. Yeah.
But we didn't start getting it here.
It, you know, there's some people that said they saw it like in early 90s, but they said it was kind of bad. Like, pretty bad. It wasn't until, like, 96 all of a sudden that, like, man, it just blew up. Like, all of a sudden it found that audience, finally.
Yeah.
And it blew up.
Well, because I remember coming home after school with you guys and watching the Frieza saga. And that was, like, the extent of my Dragon Ball
watching. Well, again, you know, it stems, again, my origins from Marquise.
Yeah.
Marquise showed Will. Will show me,
right?
You know, so
right. I even your mom even bought me a shirt. I had a blue Dragon Ball shirt for like a long time.
Whatever. Yeah, because I still remember a story. Where it was like, yeah, Marquise was like in CM's living room with like a blanket over him, like, and he was like, "Hey, Will, check out this little guy. He's gonna throw this big guy, you know, up in the air." And, you know, for us, I was like weird. I was like, you know, it's Vegeta and Nappa when he kills Nappa when he, you know, and he kills him.
Yeah.
You know, and so that's what got him.
Vegeta definitely the Dr. Doom of the Dragon Ball world.
And then I saw it, and it got me. It hooked me as a, you know, a 10-year-old at that time. It hooked me right away. I was like, whoa. Like,
dude, that Frieza saga, watching it with you guys, I remember I was like, I fucking hated him so much. I was like, I cannot wait for this guy to get his ass beat. Like, I was like watching, literally waiting for that. I was like, when are they going to kill or beat up this guy?
See, for me, it was the same one, because I was like, you know, Nappa and Vegeta fucked him up bad.
Yeah.
Like, they killed Tien, they killed Chaozu, right. They killed Yamcha, they killed Piccolo. I was like, man. And then Vegeta just beat the shit out of Goku. You know? Like, it was like, holy shit.
I'll always remember Friday Night Albert, he always loves to be like, Chaozu! I'm like, you stupid ass. Real quick, some comments before we get going here. Kara says, takes me all the way back to Saturday mornings and a bowl of cereal, the good old days. Absolutely, Kara. When I rewatched the Thundercats a couple of years ago for an episode we guessed on, I sat and watched it on the couch with cereal, too, and I was like, damn, this is going.
And it's funny because I woke up so early that my mom and dad weren't really awake,
yeah.
So I would have the leftovers of whatever we have for breakfast. Nice.
Dang, your mom put on some amazing breakfast sometimes.
And I was so eaten, but I mean, toast, man, you know, I was hungry when I woke up at 7 in the morning. Oh, yeah. So, you know, mom and dad wanted to sleep in a little bit, you know, so.
Lane says, here's the Magneto figure. Maybe it's in the private message. I'll check it out, Lane. Lane says, X-Men, Batman, man, Justice League, and shit. Challenge of the Super Friends. I forgot very about nice.
Justice League. Man, because Justice League very blew me away, too.
Yeah. No,
man, what a great cartoon that was.
I was even thinking of what kind of came to mind was that of all cartoons, like, I actually had a lot of love for that one Hulk cartoon. Not the 90s one, but the one where
I know what you're
where
talking
he's
about.
Like holding the big the metal that Incredible Hulk. I remember being like, and the animation was badass too. But let's not forget the Fantastic Four cartoon, the Silver Surfer one.
Did that a Silver really Surfer great one job still has a really big place in my heart.
Yeah,
that Silver Surfer cartoon is so fucking good.
Yep,
the animation at that time blew me away because it was so different.
It looked like Kirby drew the cartoon. Like, it was fucking... I rewatched a couple episodes recently.
The way it starts with, like, Galactus opening his hand and Surfer comes out is like, shit.
You know, and it's funny because my nephew's been watching the Fantastic Four one, and he says how good it is and he likes it. And I was like, oh, you should really watch the Silver Surfer one because I think it's a great in if you don't know anything about that character and you want to know, and it's just
And I remember, beautiful. Too, my wife asked me, too, and she was like, what's his character? What's his about? And I go, well... You know, this god comes to try to eat his planet, and he kind of sacrifices himself. He's like, you know, let me be your herald. I'll go look for planets, empty planets, you know, and you know, I'll help you. Just spare my planet. But I tell my wife, what he doesn't realize is Galactus wipes his whole mind.
Yeah.
So for like who knows how long, Surfer leads him to multiple planets of filled with races, you know, filled with... species, whatever you want to call them, full planets. Yeah.
Yeah, I think he even does. Like, I mean, you think that it would, like, wouldn't he just happen upon his own planet again? And he does, but Galactus is like, no, we're leaving this one alone. So he honors his agreement. You know, this hungry
bastard. But I tell my wife, so, like, he gets his memory back, but, you know, he realizes the horrors he's done. But I go, even though he realizes what it is, like, throughout the universe, Silver Surfer is known as one of the biggest threats in the universe.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's kind of like, this guy is, like, one of the biggest mass murderers in the universe. And
he's, like, the true angel of death.
Like, and they're, like, you know, and people are so afraid. Well, if he's around, that means Galactus has to be somewhere around. So it's kind of like, shit. You know, like, that's pretty heavy. That's why, like, Surfer is always, like, pretty down on himself. Because, you know, he's caused, like, they talk about Dark Phoenix, you know, eating a star, but it only caused, like, one world... He died. Surfer caused a shitload of worlds to die.
And the man could brood like no other because he truly felt because for his
crimes.
He really did.
He took out whole armadas by himself. And, like, he caused the destruction.
Talk about not escaping your guilt, right? And also a master of disguise with a trench coat and hat when he come to Earth to observe us. I was like, I will pay... top dollar to see that in a movie, Double A. I need that in this new Fantastic Four movie. I need Silver Surfer in a trench coat and a hat, you know, a fedora, just like observing us, like, oh, man.
Not like a lot. I really watched the second Fantastic Four movie because of the Surfer parts.
And you know what? Those parts that he's in are fucking
especially good. When he's locked up and he's telling Sue about the whole story. I was like,
that's deep. He surfs cool. He looks cool. He sounds cool.
Lawrence Fishburne.
Yep. I'm like, that is actually a really good Silver Surfer. Unfortunately, it's a terrible Doctor Doom. And kind of everything else is terrible, too.
Yes, yes, it is.
Yeah. I think we do get Andre Brower in there, though. Rest in peace.
Yes, he does.
Yeah.
Rest that's right. He's dead.
Yeah.
Because my wife is looking at that Brooklyn 911 or whatever. Yeah, I forgot he's dead.
I watched a couple of episodes with Jess of 6 Feet Under. So good.
It is, right?
So good.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Yeah, I was like really enjoying it. Yeah. I was like, damn, this is
they
really good.
They really are. Yeah.
The girl is the one, the daughter's the one from Cat Hardly Wait.
Yes. Yeah, my wife was like, holy shit, yeah.
You know, she's the main character, too, of that Severance, the M. Night one that's on Apple TV.
Okay.
Yeah, she's the lead or whatever. Cool. So, real quick, where am I at here?
Go up.
Oh, shit. Sorry, guys. I want to get to your last comment. Oh, yeah, there you go. Like, Spoon! Yeah, what a great thing to yell when you're going into battle. Tick. Kara says, I feel bad. I like Captain Planet. No.
No, she goes, is it bad?
No, it's not bad. No. Captain Planet is good. Yeah.
That was cool.
Kara, if you've never seen it, look up on YouTube. Watch Don Cheadle as Captain Planet.
Damn.
That's the real shit right there. Lane says, there was an original
that's the one.
Ocean dub they did in the 52 episodes when the Funimation dub started the remaining Frieza saga.
The voices changed.
And that was the difference, right? That probably made the difference. Turned from popular to unpopular.
Probably.
Character says Fantastic Four. Yes, there's an animated series, Kara, on Disney Plus. I think you have it, so you can definitely watch it now. Lane says, hello, I remember they had Thanos call Death Lady Chaos back in the story. Yes. And I always love that when that's a fine change.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you know, we kind of laugh about the Morbius having the drinking the plasma with his hands or whatever because he couldn't bite people in the neck and drink blood.
Plasma.
But it, like, wasn't horrible. No. You know what I mean? Like, these cartoons did a much better job at transitioning things than we see some movies do. Where I'm like, why'd you fuck that all up?
Yeah.
You fucked it all up. Like,
really did.
They didn't fuck it all up. They made a little
you
tweak.
Sound like, and you sound like Alec Baldwin in The Departed.
Yeah.
Fuck this up.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's just sweating like that guy, too. I was like, All right, last comment for tonight. Lane says, next week we can discuss a comic topic. Can I read?
Fuck. Next week we can discuss a comic topic. Is the surfboard surfer's penis, and he's flying around the universe on his junk.
Interesting. Very interesting, Lane. That is I don't know how we will divulge into that. We need to bring out Stan from Mallrats, where he's like, hey, your friend has an obsession with superhero body private body parts. Oh, let me ask you real quick, Double. In the end of this trailer, this X-Men episode where Cyclops says, to me, my X-Men, I was like, is that something he said in the original? I was like, man, you ripping off the Silver Surfer. Yeah, it's to me, my board. I'm like, when the fuck are you saying that for? I was like, and all of that, I feel like Gambit and Wolverine would be like, man, I ain't your X-Men, bitch. Oh, we work for Xavier.
They're all like this behind his back.
Yeah, we work for Xavier, man. Damn, I was like, where's Wolverine gonna fucking throw a punch on this guy? I need to bring that image back up right here. And here we go, Cyclops. And I know Jerry D, who loves Cyclops, being mad at us, but here it comes, you know? So, oh, shit, guys. It's been fucking great talking
and
with
Lane
you all.
And Lane says real quick that Professor X is the one that said that, so I guess he's...
Oh, okay.
Taking over.
All right. Take it easy, Cyclops. You know, you're not Xavier. You know. I don't know. Sometimes I feel like Xavier's a Rick Grimes type leader.
Damn.
And we need a Storm who's like a Michonne type leader. Yeah. And we're definitely going to talk about that. We're watching that.
Yeah, right? Even the ones who killed the new Walking Dead series.
The ones who live.
The ones who live. Man, I forgot why Rick pissed me off, and then I remember why in the series, and I was like, yeah, that's right, you're never going to be one of my favorite characters.
No, anymore. I know, and I'm just like, man, for so long I didn't want you to die, and I still don't want him to die, but I'm like, I'm so glad Michonne is there for you, because you fucking need help. I'm like, the show ends, and I'm like, fucking angry, you know what I mean? So,
yeah.
Lane says, to Double A and the Nature Boy, thank you.
Lane, you too, Lane. Have a great night, too.
Yes, Lane, I look forward to seeing you on After Dark next week. Always great to see you. Bud Kara, thank you for joining in tonight. Anyone else that was here with us from the Collecting Weekly family or from our own stream, we really greatly appreciate you. Guys, stickers are in circulation, Just Another Friday Night stickers. If you find them, scan them, go to our link tree, follow all of our socials. We greatly appreciate it. And hell, if you do all that and you can show me you did all that, I will send you a sticker at my own expense. So just let me know, okay? I would be happy to. Guys, something we like to say at the end of every show that we like to remind you guys is that if there's something that you want to do, a hope, a dream, something that you wish to accomplish or that you want to do, guys, go out and do it. There's no time like the present. Seize the day, guys. Carpe diem comes from one of our favorite movies, right? Double A, Dead yes. Poets Society. Do those things that need to be done. The other thing that we like to say is to quote the great Captain America, Captain Steve Rogers, and the Endgame, when he reminds the Avengers when they go back on the time heist that they must do whatever it takes. Sometimes in order to get to those hopes and dreams, you have to do whatever it takes, guys. Even if it means like Double A here, working a long, hard week, kicking ass, but still coming out to do a podcast. Or me, unfortunately, having to take time off to heal and recover and lose a lifelong piece of yourself. But hey, you got to do whatever it takes, guys. So seize the day, guys. Do whatever it takes. We're Just Another Friday Night, San Antonio's premier pop culture podcast, with Pee Breaks live on Friday night, YouTube and Facebook Live. I'm CM Chuck.
I'm Double A.
We'll see you guys next Friday night. Good night.